It's time for TWiT This Week in Tech. We have a great panel. Joining us in studio, Alex Wilhelm, Nathan Olivarez-Giles, and Roberto Baldwin. Joining us on Skype, Philip Elmer-DeWitt. He's just back from the Apple event. We'll talk about new iPhones, AirPods, what it all means, and yes, drone burrito delivery. It's all coming up next on TWiT.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for This Week in Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is TWiT, This Week in Tech, episode 579, recorded Sunday, September 11th, 2016. Burrito Shield. This Week in Tech is brought to you by IT Pro TV. IT Pro TV is an easy, entertaining approach to online IT training for a free 7-day trial and 30% off the life of your account. Go to itpro.tv/twit and use the code TWIT30. And by Blue Apron. Blue Apron will send you fresh, high-quality ingredients to cook delicious meals with simple step-by-step instructions right to your door. See what's on the menu this week and get your first 3 meals free with free shipping by going to blueapron.com/twit. That's blueapron.com/twit. And by audible.com. Sign up for the Platinum Plan and get 2 free books. Go to audible.com/twit2. And by Harry's, for guys who want a great shave experience for a fraction of what you're paying now. Go to harrys.com/twit and get $5 off your first order. It's time for TWiT This Week in Tech, the show where we cover the week's tech news. This is the post-Burning Man edition, so we're all tripping our eyes out. But welcome. No, that's not true. From TMZ, Roberto Baldwin is
here. I have pictures of you.
Yeah, you have pictures of me?
I have pictures of everyone.
Yeah. Senior editor in Gadget now. He's turned to the dark side.
Yeah,
actually, you've told me, but I didn't put two and two together about the 30-mile zone, but that's what TMZ stands for, 30-mile zone.
Yep.
I didn't even get that. It took me years.
I still don't get that. What does that mean?
The 30-mile zone is there's a radius within Hollywood where, back in the olden days, you didn't have to pay union workers a per diem. If they went outside that zone, they got a per diem in addition to their regular pay. But if they were inside that zone while they were working on TV shows or movies or whatever, they didn't get a per diem.
It also, though, was the informal agreement that this is within this zone, anything goes. You're in the industry. Mm-hmm, this is like what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. That, by the way, is Alex Wilhelm from Mattermark. Great to have you.
Good to be back. Mark,
this is the young guy edition here.
Sorry.
And also joining us, Nathan Olivares-Giles, who brought his Mac Pro. He doesn't want to be separated from it ever again. He's at the Wall Street.
In case his iPad Pro dies.
Oh, love it so much. Love it so much.
Yeah, he's got an iPad Pro and a Mac Pro. You must be a professional.
And the
ugly ass case.
Yep.
That is proof positive that Johnny Ive has been on sabbatical for at least 3 years. Also joining us via Skype, and I'm really glad to have him, Philip Elmer-DeWitt. He is the elder statesman of the Mac journalistic community. He has his new website, PED30. Which is congratulations, by the way, a wonderful site about Macintosh after he left Fortune. This is his thing. And you were at the Apple event, were you not?
I was, guilty as charged.
The only amongst us. Yesterday we had David Pogue on. And,
really?
Yeah, on the new screensavers. And he actually, I think, did a fairly good job, much better job than Phil Schiller, of justifying the loss of the headphone port. Courage was not the first thing that leapt to mind. And here we are on 9/11. The last thing you want to say is, oh, that's a courageous thing to remove the headphone jack when, you know, on this day 15 years ago, some true courageous people really...
You just totally ruined all the jokes we could have made about that.
I did that on purpose.
Super serious. That was some comedy like blocking right there.
I know. I did that because I didn't want to have no cowardly lion stuff or any courage. What does it take to take out a headphone jack? Courage.
Grit.
None of that. I don't want any of that.
Yeah.
So
can you do that voice again before we move on?
That was really good.
If I were king of Cupertino.
You can sing and I'll keep dancing.
Not king, not duke, not oil.
All right.
Courage.
Oh, it's still going.
So, Philip, I didn't want to, I guess I led with the headphone jack, but I guess for those of us going in, we thought we knew everything about what Apple was going to announce. There weren't any real surprises. The headphone jack was the one thing, though, that many of us thought, they can't do that. And then they did it.
Sure enough.
What do you think?
So weird. It's so weird because anybody who was following this, not anybody, but we knew about this. So the first rumors of this surfaced at the end of November last year. So we've had 10 months, the people who follow Apple, to kind of digest it. And I mean, I went through my five stages of grief that first day. And
so anger, denial. You finally got to acceptance?
Bargaining.
No? Bargaining.
How would you bargain?
It was weird because it surfaced in a Japanese blog that I'd never heard of. And with, you know, by the second or third derivative story, it wasn't just a rumor. It had happened. Apple had already eliminated the headphone jack. And my piece said, you know, Apple would be crazy to do this. And they're just crazy enough to do it. And sure enough, they did. But what's odd is I was not surprised. Was anybody here surprised that there wasn't a headphone jack? That was a done deal, right?
It made such business sense. But
my point is that then you turn on the nightly news and that's all anybody's talking about. I mean, the general public found out something really surprising to them and shocking.
They didn't know ahead of time, you mean.
Right. And, And now, you know, within a couple of days, have you seen the College Humor parody?
Let me play a little bit of this. It's pretty darn funny.
Most companies strive to make their products better. But at Apple, we pride ourselves on thinking different. That's why with the iPhone 7, we've done something that at first seems counterintuitive. And then is it worse.
We removed the headphone jack. And that's all. That's the newness right there. It's just the lack of a thing that was there and now it's not. It's gone. It's not there anymore. Ta-da.
Anyway, it goes on and there's some profanity as Tim Cook realizes all the downsides. Downside one, of course, you can't listen to music and charge at the same time without a $40 Belkin dongle. Apple didn't even deign to make a dongle.
I'm still surprised you can say dongle out loud and not get in trouble. But I think to Philip's point earlier about the mainstream people being confused, it shows the gap between our world and the rest of the world. So we sit here and we talk about everything.
We knew it was going to happen. We were prepared for this for months.
I've been on several twits now about this one headphone jack. Right. Now post. But I mean, everyone else was shocked. I mean, Reddit even lost its mind over this. Yeah. And I'm like, where were you guys 2 months ago? But it turns out we were on a private island. They were out in the real world. And we were confused.
One of the things that really surprised me was how many people thought that Apple just basically is no longer going to include headphones with the phone since they announced
AirPods. Well,
you
don't need one because you don't have a headphone jack.
but they're still including the headphones that now plug into the
Lightning port,
right?
Jack. And then also the $9 dongle that will do a conversion, you know, I mean, I think what you should do is add to the price of your iPhone $100 for dongles and just buy 10 or 11 dongles, right?
Throw it in.
And put them everywhere. Put them in the house. Put them. If you like headphones, I love Edemotics headphones. They have this old-fashioned thing called a headphone jack.
Oh my.
I'll just put a dongle on there, and then I can use it with the Lightning port. But in the long run, Apple's real intent. Well, first of all, let me say what David said, which I think is somewhat legitimate, which is every smartphone manufacturer would love to remove the headphone jack. He says that's a big piece of real estate inside the phone, and if you could get rid of it, that would let you do a lot more things. In Apple's case, it allowed them to do stereo speakers. It allowed them to increase the battery by 14%. Mm-hmm. It allowed them on the 7 Plus to put a dual camera in there. It allowed them to put, of dubious value, a haptic sensor for the home buttons. They didn't have to have a physical home button. They were able to do more because they had a lot more real estate. That he said, David said, that you don't understand. If you look at it, that thing takes up a lot of real estate.
Well, but the battery... like gains you get, you're going to lose them because you're using Bluetooth, which is just a battery
sock. Well,
that's
interesting.
So you're like, well, you get 14% more battery life. Yeah, but 20%, you know, I'm going to lose 20% of my battery life because I'm using Bluetooth all the time. Yeah.
So it's a net negative.
Yeah.
Well, I should also point out that Apple's long-term intent doesn't seem to be for you to use wired headphones at all.
Yep.
I mean, they are going to make some, you know, is it coincidental that Apple also owns Beats, a headphone manufacturer?
I would go and
not
say no.
No one sells more Bluetooth headphones than Beats.
Right.
So they're the number business. One and they seller announced of Bluetooth headphones.
The new Solo 3s.
I love that you know that, though. That's awesome. Of all the factors to have, number one in Bluetooth headphones. Boom, sold.
They also will be making Lightning Jack headphones. Yes. Yeah. You have to wonder, though, if Apple's going to have the courage to put a Lightning port on their laptops and take away the headphone jack there, too. I guess not, right? So they're going to have the dual platform solution? I don't understand.
USB-C, Lightning, and nothing else? I mean, could that be where it's going?
But also creates this sort of divide between your computers, you know, your iPhone's a computer, and every other audio device on the planet.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like, mm-hmm. everything else on the planet uses mini jack or quarter inch or XLR. And then there's your computers, which use something completely different. So now you've created this divide between people who love music or musicians and computer users. Like, I'm a musician, so the idea that my next iPhone won't have a mini jack
is
ridiculous. I'm not going to buy another iPhone, which sucks because I really like iOS 10. I use Apple products, but I'm like, you know what? I guess I'm going over to Android because I need to plug it into things. I need it to be able to charge. I need to be able to do stuff. I need to be able to record things with it. Yeah. I need to be able to play music while we're practicing. Like, oh, you know, we got to figure out what this part is. And I can't plug in a Lightning jack or have to walk around with an adapter all the time to plug into our mixing board.
Phil Schiller was... Go ahead, Philip.
Well, I was going to say, that's why they still sell the iPhone 6S. You know, which is now $100 cheaper.
Losers who need headphone jacks.
Right.
Until they run out.
It feels like a remedial phone, right?
Oh, dude.
How many of you are already using wireless headphones?
Well, I broke my headphone jack on my phone, so I can't actually use wired headphones.
So he's had the new phone for like 6 months.
Yeah, and it's kind of annoying.
I bought the old Beats, the Beats 2, because they were selling, they were $100 off.
Yeah.
At T-Mobile, when I was returning my Note 7, I bought those. Just to see, it's not a bad experience. I mean, I'm not crazy about the Beats sound particularly.
It does have its own sound.
It's got a kind of sound designed for hip hop, but they didn't drop. They didn't, you know, you can move around. Apple says it's going to be even better with their new W1 chip, although it's still Bluetooth.
We've
been able to verify, John Gruber and others have verified that it will still be able to pair. Any Bluetooth device will be able to pair.
It just won't have that like automatic connect. Yeah.
Quick thing. By the way, Phil Schiller is not the first person to use the word "a courage" at Apple, and this is what I think Phil was thinking about and referring to. This is Steve Jobs at the All Things D some years ago.
Apple is a company that doesn't have the most resources of everybody in the world, and the way we've succeed.
By the way, this is before Apple was the largest, most successful company in history.
What year was this? 2011?
I think so.
Is by choosing what horses to ride really carefully, technically. We try to look for these technical vectors that have a future and that are headed up. And, you know, technology, different pieces of technology kind of go in cycles. They have their springs and summers and autumns, and then they, you know, go to the graveyard of technology. And so we try to pick things that are in their springs. And if you choose wisely, you can save yourself an enormous amount of work versus trying to do everything. And you can really put energy into making those new emerging technologies be great on your platform rather than just okay because you're spreading yourself too thin. So we have a history of doing that. As an example, we went from the 5-inch floppy disk to the 3.5-inch floppy disk with the Mac.
Before other people, right?
We were the first to do that. We made the 3.5-inch floppy disk popular. Sony invented it, and we put it in the first products. And there were some good reasons we did that. We got rid of the floppy disk altogether in 1998 with the first iMac. We also got rid of these things called serial and parallel ports. And we were the first to adopt USB, even though Intel had invented it. You first saw it in mass on iMacs. And so we have gotten rid of things. We were one of the first to get rid of optical drives with the MacBook Air. And I think things are moving in that direction as well. And sometimes when we get rid of things like the floppy disk drive on the original iMac, people call us crazy.
Or at least premature, maybe.
No, they call us crazy.
Oh, okay.
But sometimes you just have to pick the things that look like they're going to be the right horses to ride going forward.
And what if people say, you know, the iPad is crippled in this respect?
Well, you know, well, I'd say two things. Number one,
I should have queued this up to the courage.
Some things are emphasis, but we're going to take the heat because we want to make the what best product in the world for customers.
Let me cue this up to the.
It's a great clip.
And
well, you see, by the way, when you watch this, you see why Steve Jobs was so good at what he does. And Phil Schiller is, you know, if Phil had explained it this way, maybe we would be a little less mocking.
It was the use of the word
him.
Courage.
Well, here's how Steve used it.
We're making the wrong choices. We listen to the market. We're just people running this company. We're trying to make great products for people. And so we have at least the courage of our convictions to say, we don't think this is part of what makes a great product. We're going to leave it out.
That's the courage of our convictions as opposed to Phil Schiller courage. Which isn't the same thing at all.
Yeah, it's a different, you know, it's a different
it's not
context.
The red badge.
We have the courage of our convictions to move forward and to remove these nearly antiquated tech products.
But let me ask you, is the headphone jack one of those?
We're going to find out. We're going to find out if other manufacturers remove the headphone jack, Apple will have been proved right. And if nobody buys the iPhone 7 because it doesn't have a headphone jack, and they could be proved wrong. Let me make one point. Somebody
tweeted at me, if Apple had sold the Fire Phone, they would have sold 10 million of them.
I don't think so. No.
At this point, is it people will buy it just because it's an iPhone? Go ahead, Philip.
There's a couple of things, and then I'll tell you what the AirPods are like. iPods.
I'm very interested because AirPods are the future, right? The AirPods are what Apple wants the future to hold.
Yeah. The what's weird about removing the headphone jack on this phone is that they didn't have to do it. There was plenty of room. The whole thing with the headphone jack is you can't put a screen over it. So there's that space at the bottom of an iPhone right now that isn't being used by the screen.
Well, but I have to point at the maligned now Note 7, which is a smaller phone than the iPhone 7 Plus with a bigger screen and a pen and a headphone jack, and they somehow managed to make it all work, and it's waterproof. So it is, I'm not sure I completely buy Apple's explanation that they had to do it for engineering.
Yeah, well, I don't buy it at all. Anyway, I think the deal is that they were going to do it next year with that 10th anniversary phone, and they didn't want that phone to come out, and anybody did was talk about that it didn't have a headphone jack. Yeah. So they're getting that out of the way this year. It's like classic Apple. You know, remember how it took them several years to get Apple Pay, all the pieces of Apple Pay in place, stage by stage. Okay, anyway, so I did go to the demo room and try out the AirPods, which I really want to call earbuds, but there you go. What you have to know is that I'm like kryptonite for demos. They always go wrong.
Good.
So
good.
Here's the scene.
That's what I want.
There's a woman with a platter of Virgin AirPods, maybe 16 of them on a platter. And when you came up for the demo, they'd take a fresh one out and hand it to you and then invite you to open up the little box, which looks like a dental floss box with a magnetic opening. And then you kind of reach in and pull out these AirPods, which are in magnetically. I actually had trouble getting my nail underneath to pull them out. Then you put them in your ear, and for me, it didn't work. I couldn't hear a thing. So they had to put that one back, get out a fresh ear pod and put that in, and it didn't work either. And then they got a third one, and it didn't work. And then I said, maybe you got to restart that iPhone. And he was afraid to do that because God knows what was going on inside the demo unit. So I had to wait for them to get a whole new iPhone and then a fourth AirPod, and finally it worked. And I tell you, I'm not an audio expert. They sounded great.
Do they sound better than the current wired?
I'm not qualified to say. They sounded really good.
Pogue said they sound the same as the current wired, which would be very disappointing because they are $160.
Yeah.
I would expect them to have better sound for that price.
But they're shaped exactly the same, and the actual audio components are essentially the same as
so
well.
So it should sound the same.
So it should sound the same.
So all the money
goes
into...
They're going to be like, and this is 40% lower bass and 13% more sound than Windows. Yeah.
They didn't talk about that, did they? You're paying for that cool little... The thing that looks like the icicle dripping
out of your ear.
Yeah, you're paying for dental floss box.
Yeah, and by the way, and a little annoying that you Bluetooth. Have mic, you have ear dribbles on both sides.
Mm-hmm. Do you want a mono dribble or a stereo dribble?
Well, it's because there's a mic in both. So if you use just one, there's sensors that will know if you're wearing just one, and then you can use either one as a headset.
Really?
And it's smart enough to know when you put them in, it knows you put them in your ear, and it automatically switches the sound from whatever you were using to the AirPods. And then if you want to talk to someone, you take one out and it lowers the volume on the other one and you can talk, and then you put it back in and it knows you've done it. That's all pretty cool. The downside, and I think this is actually a serious problem, is that there's no volume control. And the way you control the volume, it's all done through Siri. So you have to sort of get Siri's attention and say, you know, make it louder. And
you can't turn it up?
No.
Not even with the phone?
Well, with the phone
you can.
But
yeah.
not there's no buttons.
So the little button thing we had before is gone. So I can't just be like click.
By the way, Ben Stiller invented this in the movie Something About Mary. Was the first appearance of ear pods. I don't know if you remember that scene. But that's an ear pod right there.
He really was ahead of his time.
He was ahead of his time.
Have you seen the pictures of Anne Frank and all the other people with little ear pods, the people from the old commercial?
I did read an article, and I wish I could remember who, because I can't give him credit, but I would like to, that I kind of agree with. I've been saying for a while that hearables are going to be the breakthrough with wearables. It's not going to be a watch. It's not going to be glasses. But if you're already wearing earbuds... it's coming from both directions. In terms of hearing aids, I have hearing aids from Starkey that pair with my phone that I can use to listen to music and books. Broggy's making these. If you have something in your ear, it could also not just measure steps, but it could measure
your heart rate.
Yeah. It could measure blood oxygen. It could probably even measure blood pressure because there's such a thin membrane between your blood and in the ear. That these could be the future of wearables. And that's the argument for these earpods, that there's a lot of technology in them. They're not just headphones. Mm-hmm. The AirPods they have accelerometers.
Right.
They have beam-forming microphones. They have noise canceling.
When I heard all of that, I got a lot less mad about them and got excited about where they'll be in 3 years. Because I think that we can all agree that this is a limited... Like, the first Kindle was too expensive, didn't do a lot, but had potential. And by Kindle 3, whatever it was called, it was incredible, low-cost, and amazing. So to me, Apple is saying, hello, world. We're all going to go here eventually. We're taking the first step, back to your courage point, and then we'll all get there eventually, hopefully us first. But I am willing to look ahead and say, that sounds super cool in 2000, what year is it, 16? So 19. Yeah. So I can't add today.
Well, but and it's going to be janky until then because the battery life's going to be bad. Yeah. You're going to have to
put 5 hours. What the? I mean, they're actually selling some Beats headphones, a new set called the Beats X that have the same W1 chip in it. And they're going to sell for, I think, a couple, you know, 20, 30 bucks less. And they have something like 10 hours of battery life.
Did they call the Beats X?
They're called the Beats X.
They never said out loud before they sold them, did they?
I don't know. Yeah. Not the best.
Beats X?
Beats X.
Well, there's that way to say it, too. I was alluding to that, Leo. Not going. Yeah.
But, you know, I think you're right. You know, it's about building this kind of wireless future, right? And they even talked about it. I think Johnny Ive in his video said, you know, for years we've been working on this future with no wires for any of our products. And I mean, if you look at the new MacBook, there's one USB-C port on it, but really they want you to be using wireless stuff to transfer your files. Mm-hmm. They don't want you to be using wired hard drives or any of this sort of thing. The iPad has, you know, one port for charging because how else are you going to charge it? As soon as they can get you wireless charging, and well, they could now, but as soon as they start implementing wireless,
they have all
charging,
that extra room because they took the headphone jack out. They should have wireless charging.
Well I think eventually the charging port's going to disappear and you'll have wireless
that
charging.
That is a little frustrating. They don't have wireless charging.
Yeah.
They also don't allow anybody else to use NFC. I guess in Japan now, Finca will use NFC.
I would love to use NFC for like my Clipper card.
Yeah.
My phone, just like...
Well, and an Android device, I hate to say it, you can. So... I'm really torn on this. On the one hand, I want Apple to innovate. Farhad Manju writes a scathing article in the New York Times saying that really Apple has lost its mojo, that they aren't innovating anymore.
I love Farhad.
He sort of backed off that with his next piece, saying how much he actually loved all this stuff. So I am with him
because I have the same exact. Don't we all have the same exact mm-hmm. mixed feelings? On the one hand, we want to believe, we want it to be the Apple that brought us the iPod, that brought mm-hmm. us the iPad, that brought us the iPhone, which is probably the single biggest technological revolution in my lifetime. And at the same time, we look at this stuff and we wonder: are we being taken for a ride? At what point is this innovation? At what point is it just fins on a Cadillac? Is it just innovation for, you know, to get you to buy the next one? Yeah.
I don't know if we're being taken for a ride, but I'm definitely in Apple's car and I'm not getting off. Like
I notice all of you have iPhones.
I'm in the car, but I'm already like unlocking the door. I'm waiting for the next stoplight to turn red.
Yeah. He's gonna get on Muni and go nowhere.
There's apps on here that I can't get on Android that I really like, and I'm just like, that's going to suck.
I'll give you an example.
I use this little port way more than I use those apps.
The hardware innovation is one thing, but Apple has completely ignored any software innovation on iOS. The iOS features they're adding, things like messages with balloons.
And stickers.
And meanwhile, the Springboard interface on iOS is positively antiquated.
Is that bad, though? It's really good.
You feel like maybe it's the way it should be. It's easy to use. We don't need to make it fancy.
Yeah, this interface that I've had since the iPhone original is solid, quick, easy to use, intuitive.
But you just said it. Since 2007.
And it's rocked.
Right. But see, here's the thing.
Metallica's rocked since 83, man. Metallica's still good.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it. Bingo. Which is this.
All right. That's not grammatical.
I think part of what's at play here is with PCs, we were used to our software not changing dramatically every year or every 2 years.
Don't use Windows, do you?
Yeah. We held on to laptops and desktops for a long time. Apple helped create this cycle where every year there's something new. And every 2 years you're buying a new device. So now they're getting dinged for not being able to keep up with this pace. But they kind of originated this pace, and Samsung lives up to it now as well. The whole mobile market is judged by how many phones you can sell every year or two, right? So to a certain extent, I think there is some of this. We are actually building like a great future. There's going to be some cool stuff. All this wireless stuff's going to make sense, you know, 5-10 years down the road. But in the short term, they also have to have something new to say on stage every single year. And so I think there's a little bit of both at play here.
You're being a bit nice, because that's why we had the S releases, 6S, 5S, 4S. We give them a year off.
But again, they created this 2-year cycle.
Oh, no, it's their fault, but we shouldn't let them off the hook. I mean, when they say iPhone 7, I expect that to be a full feature numbered release as opposed to a 0.5, which the S is usually.
But part of the problem is this is a fairly well-evolved product. You don't want to just change it for change's sake.
Exactly.
You want to improve it. Philip, what's your feeling? You've been watching this since 1984, for crying out loud. This isn't the same Apple, is it? I mean, after all.
Well, it was pretty messed up in 1984. they had to fire the co-founder. I think you've said it. The smartphone is on an S curve. It's an immensely successful product. Apple is making sustaining improvements every year. This was a little disappointing in terms of a sustaining improvement because it was the same form factor and all that kind of stuff. I sort of look to see, well, is there something I come out of this thing saying, geez, I got to have that. I really, really want to have that. And I got to say, I want to have those AirPods. I don't care so much about the new
18 AirPods. Mm-hmm. I mean, I feel these are going to be a little bit of a struggle. They're going to be a little challenging. But I think they're in the right. They're moving in the right direction. I think that explains the loss of the headphone port. We're going to go wireless.
That's exactly.
And it's going to be better.
I mean, the future of computing is going to be all wireless with implants in our brain that talk to us. It's going to be awesome. This is just step 0.001 on that. You know.
I have to point out that one of the things we've said is, well, the market will decide whether it moves. And the market seems to quite like this new phone. We were talking before the show. It was darn hard to get one.
Yeah.
We all, I don't know, I stayed up to midnight. Philip, you would have had to stay up to 3 a.m. to get one. And they, I was trying to get a jet black. They were gone instantly. I wonder if they even had any.
I think they made those in much smaller numbers,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah. So those are pushed off to October 4th, and they're now November. In fact, I think all of them are now November. So while we, you know, and Apple said, we're not going to give you sales numbers from the weekend because it's supply constrained, not demand constrained. So we can't make any decision about demand because we don't know what the supply is. But presuming that Apple did what it usually does, which made millions of them ahead of time, mm-hmm. the market did weigh in. They loved it.
Do you think they made less? I mean, iPhone sales have been, you know, slowly going down. They're like, you know what? Let's be smart about this. Let's not make too many iPhones. I mean, Apple's been really smart about its inventory. Anything that's sitting in a warehouse is losing money.
I'll tell you why I don't think so. Because when they say before they go on sale, we're not going to give you numbers because it's supply constrained, they're saying the demand will be higher than whatever number we've made.
That's always been true.
Company wants it to be that way. You'd like to sell an iPhone to every single person who wants one on day one.
And make one more than that.
Right.
Exactly.
Plus one.
And so it's dork plus
maybe,
one.
Maybe it's hard to make, although I can't think it's that hard to make because it's essentially the same exact phone as last year. Maybe the jet black is hard to make.
There's a guy with like some needle nose pliers just pulling out headphone jacks, putting some Bondo over the hole.
They've done nothing in this phone to set to justify. Oh well, this is tricky. It's going to take us a while.
Okay, true. But I can imagine the AirPods in 2 years being so cool that I feel the need to buy a new iPhone to get me off my current 6, which I love, because it can't ever do those.
So will you buy a 7?
I'm going to buy the 7S because my cycle goes through.
You're okay. On the S?
Yeah, I'm on the S cycle, sadly.
Now, some people here, none of whom shall be named, already have one because they're on the review circuit. Don't look at me.
What?
Don't look at me.
Don't look at me.
I was able to get one on Friday. It'll come on Friday. But only because I was willing to use a less popular color.
What color did you end up getting?
Gold.
Gold, there you go.
Yeah.
2-year-old color. Not even rose gold.
Gold. I'd like to see him like mix it up with like a blue or something like that.
There was a rumor, blue, right?
So gauche.
Yeah. I would like an orange iPhone.
So
I just want an orange iPhone.
It's kind of between rose gold and gold. It's like,
let's take a little break. And Philip, if you want to stick around, you're more than welcome to. We're going to talk about the watch next. I don't know if you have anything to say about the watch.
Get excited.
I wouldn't mind buying that. I want to tell you my Angela Ahrens close encounter story. There's a pecking order to the journalists who come to these things, and I'm not one of the ones who got invited early to see the things before the keynote.
Some people did though, huh?
Yeah.
Who was that?
Oh, like Buzzfeed, Ben Behrman, and I assume Walt Mossberg. There was this scene, you know, Mark Gurman made his first appearance at one of these things. There was like this power group of Mossberg, Niley.
So when Gurman was at 9 to 5, he was a persona non grata at Apple because he had all the scoops. But now that he's with Bloomberg, he gets to go.
That's right.
Interesting.
Anyway, I'm coming in late to see the demo room, and there's Angela Ahrens coming towards me. Now, when they first hired Angela Ahrens for umpteen billion dollars, she looked so good, and I thought
she was the
CEO
of Burberry they hired to run retail, and they had to really buy her out of her contract because she isn't CEO, obviously, at Apple, so they had to give her a ton of money.
Right. She gave up a CEO position to be the head of retail, and it seemed like it only made sense for her if there was an upward trajectory. And I thought she was going to be a great on-screen presence, kind of female Steve Jobs.
And we haven't seen hide or hair of her.
And so I wrote several things saying, when are we going to see her on stage? So there she was in front of me, and I said, Angela, when are we going to see you on stage? And she touched my shoulder and said, me, never.
Really?
Huh. Yeah.
That's her choice, it sounds like.
There's a little piece of news.
Do you think
her.
It's her choice?
Yeah, I do. I don't know what they had in mind for her, but I can see her being in a room with Schiller and these old war horses who've been playing Apple politics from day one and thinking, oh, geez.
I'll be honest. Phil has made too many blunders at this point. I would not put Phil Schiller on the stage again. He is living up to his name, a total shill. First, he tells us about the Mac Pro and says, innovate my ass. And then, they just forgot about it for the last 3 years. And lately, courage, you know, completely bungles that. That is... I think Schiller's the guy not to put on stage, and I bet you Angela Arendt. She's spoken to the retail people.
She apparently does
quite a good job. I think they should bring her on stage.
She has weekly things with them.
Right.
She's a big presence within retail, but according to her, she's not going to be a big presence on stage.
To Apple's credit, lots of diversity on stage. Enough women so that you didn't have to say, oh, they have a woman anymore. They're to be very much praised for that. And I have to point out that their camera, we were talking about this during the event. There was an article a few months ago about how it might be the way Kodak film was made that contributed to the racism in this country, because black skins came out very much darker. Mm-hmm. Almost completely featurelessly dark compared to white skins. The film was made for Caucasians and disadvantaged anybody else. Apple showed, every time they showed samples from their camera, they made sure they had a person of color in those images, and they looked great.
They did.
And I think this is Apple tacitly saying, we embrace diversity and we want to make sure our products work for everyone. And I have to praise them for that.
No, that's good. I mean, and when I was in film school, like my cinematography teacher was an African-American woman. She's like, my skin, it's so hard to shoot for me because that's not what film is made for.
They don't make it for.
Yeah. The film isn't made for my skin.
Right.
And she's like, so, you know, she was telling us like the tricks and things you can do. Yeah.
It's been the case for years.
Yeah. And this is Kodak, Fuji. I mean, all of them.
Yeah. So, Philip, we're going to let you go unless you want to stick around. You're always welcome. You know that.
Well, call me anytime.
Okay.
Thanks.
Go visit Philip's site. There's lots more there, including a rundown of what analysts think about this. We don't report on that so much because I don't care what the stock market thinks. But if you go to PED 30, you can at least see that and lots more. And Philip does a great thing with PED 30. There's a free article every day, but there's also paid articles, and the subscriptions are what keeps him going. 17 buys, 3 holds, and 1 sell. Sounds like Wall Street liked what they heard. Philip, thank you so much for joining us. PED30.com.
Thank you, Leo.
Take care. We're going to take a break, come back with more. We will talk about the watch, because you said you want to talk about the watch.
I pointed very carefully at your screen. Be able to.
I feel like Apple's kind of almost tacitly saying, yeah, that watch, that's not doing so good. But we'll see. We'll see if Series 2 can change it. We'll talk about that when we come back. Our show today brought to you by IT Pro TV, a great way if you're an IT professional to keep up with your business, a great way if you want to be an IT professional to get into the business. You know, you got to get those certs for that first job, but it's tough. You can go to a technical school and spend tens of thousands of dollars. You can buy study materials, spend thousands of dollars. This is a new way and a better way. IT Pro TV. And even if you're already an IT pro, a good IT pro is always learning, and it's the best way to stay up to date with current technology, to get those certs. They're high-quality video tutorials, thousands of hours of content, and they add 30 more every week. In fact, we're going to fly out to Florida. They're opening their new studio in the next couple of weeks, and we're going to go say hi to Tim and Don there in Gainesville, because I think they have 5 new studios. 5! And as somebody who just built 1 new studio, I can appreciate the effort that goes into that. They are really ramping up to bring you courses on every topic. Right now, CCNT, CCNA Routing and Switching, CISM. They're doing those great Certified Ethical Hacker courses. What a great cert that'd be. I'd love that. Apple, Amazon, Cisco, everything. And you have transcripts so you can follow them from start to finish or find the part of the video you want to watch and jump right to that. You can stream them on your Chromecast, your Roku, your Fire TV. They have an Apple TV app. Of course, you can watch on your PC or your tablet. And if you buy your subscription by the year instead of the month, you can even download them and watch them offline. These guys are great. They have virtual machine labs, so you don't even have to own a copy of Windows Server or a Windows. You could do it all from an HTML5 browser. You could take the exam before you take the exam with their Transcender practice exams. That's worth $109 just by itself. They've got study groups. They've got Q&A time. They really do a wonderful job. And as far as corporate goes, pretty much everybody, every major university, Harvard, MIT, UCSD, Stanford, are clients of IT Pro TV. That's how they keep their IT team up to snuff. And if you have a enterprise account with a competitor, and you just got a rate increase, I think you know who you are. IT Pro TV will match your previous year's pricing on that account, so you and your team can continue to learn at an affordable rate. Go to itpro.tv/twit to get a very special deal. 30% off the life of your account and 7 days free when you use the offer code TWIT30. That's itpro.tv/twit, and the offer code is TWIT30. We're talking about the week's tech news. Great panel. Always love having these young guys in.
I'm actually 57.
Yeah, see, he looks really good though for his age.
Doesn't he look good? Yeah. Wow, that's Roberto.
That's why my bones are so brittle.
Yeah, we had you scheduled a few weeks ago, and you had to bail because you broke your foot. Are you okay?
Yeah.
You feeling better?
Yeah. I broke my ankle chasing a kitten down the stairs, which is a very...
That's not true.
That's actually true.
You don't work for BuzzFeed, do you?
No.
If
BuzzFeed were to give me a job to just write about
kittens, you would.
Just to write and chase kittens, I would be, yeah, sure. I'll do that. I'll give up everything.
But it was a street fight, actually.
It was a street fight with a kitten.
And you lost, apparently.
I lost. A kitten.
Or you ought to see the kitten.
Yeah, no. The kid looks fine. Was really just sitting in the corner, like, kid's fine.
How big is it? Is it a little kitten?
Yeah, he's a little kitten. He's like,
don't chase kittens.
6 months old now.
Ask what his cat's names are. He has two.
What are your cat's names?
Oh, so we got two brothers, two kittens, and they're named Siegfried and Roy.
Oh, that's cute. Oh, that's good.
You were so proud of yourself. You're like, watch this. Whoop.
I love that.
I think it's hilarious.
Nathan Olivarez-Giles, always setting up his friends. It's great to have you two from the Wall Street Journal.
I have no pets.
We can't. You have no weaknesses.
But I'm the go-to dog sitter for all my friends.
Oh, that's nice.
Because I have
that's
no good. Pets.
That's
so,
true.
You know.
That's nice.
Yep.
Your Instagram lights up when you get a dog.
My Instagram lights up, and
were you posting Goron pictures before? Was that you?
I was.
Goron, the French bulldog.
Yeah, that's Mark's Millian.
He still has Goron, right?
Yep, still got him.
Okay. And also with us, Alex Wilhelm from Mattermark. Hello. Are an analyst. You follow the markets as well.
I do indeed track the markets. Yeah. And you made fun of my entire hobby and pastime before the break. So
what's your hobby and pastime?
The stock market. So now we're just not friends
anymore. No, I'm not making fun of it. I'm saying that...
Oh, I see. Back it up.
I'll tell you exactly.
Okay.
The problem, first of all, analysts are talking to a different audience. They're talking to an investor audience. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about the value of the products, the utility of the product, whether a company is a good company. That isn't necessarily the important news for an investor.
Definitely not.
Right?
Well, I'm not actually an analyst. I don't really write for investors. So
no, I'm not talking about you.
No, in general, I think you're totally correct there. And that's why there's a disconnect between the Wall Street chatter we hear, what we talk about here in tech, and what the public itself hears.
Yeah.
And there's three different conversations, which is why we get confused when new things come out and the stock market doesn't change its value of the stock at all. And we go, well, why not? Because, again, different conversation, different topics even. So it's just...
Well, and I say that as a cautionary tale to our audience who, you know, the news is going to cover if an Apple stock goes down after an announcement. They're going to say, oh, look, the market tanked. But it isn't necessarily in reaction to the announcement.
For sure.
You know, you buy on the rumor, you sell on the news. There's all they're working on a different level and a different plane than a normal user is. So I think that the utility of stock market information, of earnings and all of that, isn't really completely useful to what we do.
But we do depend on it for unit volumes, revenue growth, year-over-year declines, you know, segment changes.
Well, I certainly would love to know, for instance, if this iPhone sells as well as previously.
Exactly. And, but you don't really care about their non-GAAP EPS before extraordinary items.
Oh, I do.
Oh, I do too.
Which one is GAAP again?
GAAP's the good one, non-GAAP is the bad one. Non-GAAP is like Diet Coke or decaf coffee. You don't trust it.
I'm totally confused.
No, but I totally understand that. And that's why I think it's good to have all three conversations. What works for our parents, what works for us, what works for the
markets. But I do the cautionary thing every time we do stock market stuff. Because it really, you have to read it with the right eye. What I care about, and what I think our audience cares about, is should I buy this phone?
Right.
Is Apple doing the right thing? Is this a sensible plan?
Yeah.
Not what's their stock going to... Although... And I mentioned this also, the stock price does have some importance to companies like Apple and Twitter, for instance, because that's how they compensate employees. It gives them, it's an important tool for them to be able to hire good engineers. Yep. Speaking of which, Apple apparently is backing down on the car. They have laid off, I'm jumping way ahead, we'll go back to the watch in a second. Uh-huh, uh-huh. But according to the New York Times, Daisuke Wakabayashi, who does some great reporting on Apple and Brian X. Chen, say that Apple, according to their sources, is rethinking the self-driving car, has laid off dozens of employees. They've got three different people on this. And this doesn't surprise me at all. I really didn't think this was a good direction for Apple to be going in anyway.
Super crowded. And I think everyone thought the automakers, especially these tech companies, thought the automakers were just going to sit on their laurels and let them, and you know, let the Googles and the Apples and the Microsofts.
They're going to let
the
them take the
car.
Arrows, and as soon as they got it figured out, GM's going to say thank you. We'll take
it
from
here. Everyone's working. Mercedes is working on it. Audi's working on it. Yeah. GM's. Everybody is working on, you know, and Ford super hardcore into anything mobility, including autonomous driving. So the automakers are really stepping up. They're really pushing super hard.
They sandbagged. I think they pretended lack of interest. I remember asking for it every year. So tell me about your autonomous car. What's his name would always say, oh, no, people love to drive. We're never doing an autonomous car. Yeah. And I said, come on, you got Alan Lally, you got a guy in the back working on this. No. Wait, of course they did.
You asked Alan that question?
Yes.
That's awesome.
Year after year I asked him that.
How often do you have dinner with this guy?
Actually, I don't know why, but Alan used to give me great access.
Yeah, Alan, what happened to that? Also, my access?
I haven't talked to Mark. Mark Hurd, Mark Lane,
the new guy.
Yeah. Mark Hurd's the old CEO of HP. That's another story entirely now at Oracle.
Because I got into an argument with Ford a couple of years ago about putting in cell phone connectivity actually into vehicles. It was 4 or 5 years ago. And they said, it's too expensive. We don't have the margins for it. We can't do it. No one wants it. And of course,
then they
now,
did it.
Right? And it's incredibly popular.
I think, given the time frame of car companies, 5 years at least, they're working on all this stuff. They know.
Oh, they've been working on it forever.
Yeah. I think they're working on all this. I think you're also seeing the interest and the focus for pretty much all the tech companies that are involved moving towards alliances and towards building software.
Well, that's what we thought maybe Apple would want to do.
Yeah.
Tesla's Elon Musk has always said the key for us is to do it all. You need the information you get from the cars to improve the software. Mm-hmm. You can't outsource. In fact, they've even brought the cameras and everything in-house now because Elon said, no, we have to do it all to get that information. Data is very important. Yeah.
Today's announcement about the Autopilot 8.0 that's coming out in the next 2 weeks, they did all of it in-house. Yeah. They didn't use Mobileye because, you know, they sort of broken up with Mobileye.
That's the camera company.
Now their next update to the Autopilot, to the in-car is infotainment system, is all in-house. It's all Tesla. They're doing everything. That means they're getting all the information.
It's a great car for a geek. For instance, when you turn up the sound, it goes to 11.
Yeah.
There's lots of little things
when I was driving the Model X, I was turning everything up. You could turn up the fan goes to 11. Everything 11. Goes to 11.
Awesome. They just added in 7.1 because they update. I get updates as often as I do on a phone or a computer. I mean, they update every few weeks. On 7.1, if you tap the autopilot twice, normally you turns on autopilot four times, you get a rock riff coming out of your radio and a rainbow road stretching out ahead of you.
Wow.
I'm sure it's a reference to something I don't know.
Rainbow from Super Mario Brothers. Mario Kart.
It's Mario Kart. Yeah. So you're driving Mario Kart.
Yeah.
So that song, get in the car with me after the show and you can tell me.
Whoa, Stranger's Cars, I was told. Sorry.
Oh. We know him, sort of.
I've got candy.
Oh, he's got candy. And he needs help looking for his lost puppy.
Is that why the doors are locked? Okay.
Anyway, back to Apple. But I thought that was interesting. Well, this is Apple, isn't it? Apple kind of pulling back on something that people. It's like the TV. I never bought it. I thought
The margins on TV are so slim. Yeah. I think they were just very much, let's work on something and look at it. Apple's going to do R&D on a ton of stuff they'll never release, just so they either A, they know the market, or B, they'll be ahead in case there's a change.
Well, and when you have $200 billion in the bank, you can afford
just some money to spend.
I'll throw a billion at that.
You know what, Ed? Autonomous goats. They're probably working on it.
That's a great idea. So that's the just, watch.
Wait, hold on.
Tim Cook.
Autonomous goats. I love it.
Go for it.
There's a billion. Go make it so. We got that old warehouse in Sunnyvale. We're not using that anymore. Go in there.
Johnny Ives just sitting in the corner.
These are the most
starts drawing
feral
goats
we've ever made.
Okay, but just keep in mind that when you look at Apple's cash position, you just deduct
it's all
their
European,
debt.
It's all European,
I know. Yeah, it's foreign currency and they have a lot of domestic debt. So it looks like a lot more than it is. Just keep that in mind.
So they need foreign goats. Coming to America and taking our American ghost jobs is what you're saying.
Make goats great again.
Oh, God. This has devolved really quickly.
Goats 2016.
Goats.
Right. Apple Watch Series 2. First of all, I feel so bad for anybody who bought the gold Apple Watch.
I don't think many people did, considering they basically got rid of the $10,000.
Without a word, they dropped it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There's no upgrade path for it.
No.
At least if somebody spends $10,000 on a watch, you could say we could put the new guts in. You want those? But no.
I think the $10,000 watches were bought by the same people who buy $10,000 bags.
It was nothing for them.
$7,000 shoes.
$7,000 shoes?
They're
TMZ. He knows.
Yeah. Oh, right. I drove around with a $20,000 dress in the back of my $500 Honda Civic once.
But it looked great on you.
$20,000 dress.
It was black and slim.
It was great. It was really slimming. I didn't have the shoes for it, though. I was still wearing the Converse.
$7,000 shoes.
Yeah.
It's hard to get those pumps in size 11.
The people who bought the $10,000 watch, I would say a majority of them were the people who were
didn't care.
Yeah. They're like, I bought a watch. Look at this.
Well, Pharrell gets in the car, right? In the beginning of the Apple event, they're James Corden. It's kind of sad because Apple bought Carpool Karaoke, but fired James Corden. They're not going to use him in their Carpool Karaoke.
Who's going to host it? Who's going to host it?
Some other person.
What the
hell? Johnny Ive.
Johnny Ive. Let's all sing along.
That's what he's been doing all this time. He's working on his vocal performance.
Anyway, Corden's driving.
He's got a nice voice.
Tim Cook. And then who gets in the car? Pharrell. And of course, remember when the gold Apple Watch came out, we saw Pharrell's Instagram with that beautiful gold
Kanye
watch.
Kanye had one. Pharrell had one. Jay-Z had one.
Pharrell was wearing a giant regular watch. He wasn't even wearing an Apple Watch when he gets in the car.
Yeah.
So that's got to hurt, right? $1 million we paid him to sit in the back
James
seat
Corden
for 5 seconds.
James Corden was wearing an Apple Watch, though.
I was he?
But not
an Apple Watch, but not a gold
one. Yeah.
So now here comes the Series 2. The addition, there still is a high-priced one, is white ceramic.
It looks beautiful. I really think it looks nice.
Can we get a picture of it? Do you want to have one?
On Apple's website.
Not too lazy.
I'll show you. So the problem is it's $1,299.
Which is a huge discount from $10,000 for the highest end watch.
It does seem cheap, doesn't it?
It's $9,000 off.
People say ceramic, that can't be right. But no, this is not, you know, like a porcelain doll ceramic.
Yeah.
Is it Corningware?
They say it's harder than aluminum.
It's harder than steel. It's twice as hard as steel. It does not scratch. Like all glasses, it could shatter if hit in a certain way, but really you have to.
You really got to give it a.
Yeah. So
it looks
just like
the old one.
Give it the business.
I've had analog ceramic watches in the past. They're very nice, but I had black. I didn't have white. This looks like, and it comes with a rubber band. I'm sorry, in a lost flowlimer blend. So, $12.99, and of course I bought one because I have to.
You actually
well,
don't.
Well, for your Tesla, if you get in a Tesla with a regular Apple Watch, it won't start.
No, because I'm going to take a hammer to it. I want to see.
Whoa, you are?
Sure, why not?
Can I do it?
I gotta live stream that.
I volunteer. No, because I
he volunteers.
I always buy whatever, like the new color.
See how breakable it is.
Well, there's no point in reviewing the gold phone. You got to review the jet black phone. Mm-hmm. And there's no point in reviewing a stainless steel Apple Watch. We already know about that one.
True that.
So I bit the bullet. $12.99. You know, for a watch, actually, if you buy nice watches, is not horrifically
bad. Expensive. I do wonder though, and this is actually something you know I wish we could have talked about when Philip was still on, but. You know, in hiring, Burberry's CEO to come and run retail, that's a big luxury move. Huge
Absolutely.
Luxury ambitions.
That's saying Apple's a fashion brand.
Exactly. And redesign the stores like they did with the Union Square one in San Francisco. And
it's
they
a
say
forest.
They're gonna do, it's gorgeous. Huge, right? Yeah. And with releasing a $10,000 gold Apple Watch, that's you know, high-end fashion stuff. They brought those to, like, you know, Paris runways and all this. Now I feel like it seems like they're trying to scale things back a little bit.
Isn't that interesting? No gold watch is retrenching.
And when they talked about the Apple Watch at this event last week, the focus was specifically on fitness, which makes sense. That's the best thing the Apple Watch is for at this point. And they had that partnership with Nike. They still have the Hermes version.
That was a lot smaller during this announcement, though, compared to the Nike.
Exactly.
Shockingly.
The focus now, to me, it seems sports. Like, is sports and fitness.
They've added the ability to swim. It's got now waterproof, so you can use it as a swimmer.
I wonder if they're trying to... I'm not saying they're giving up on the luxury and ambitions. I mean, they still make products that are generally more expensive than their competitors.
Yeah, but let's face it. This is a thick, ugly-ass watch. This is not...
This is
not a beautiful watch.
A lot of watches are thick. There's not a lot of super thin
watches.
This
is a beautiful watch. That's an Android Wear
watch.
That's
probably just as thick.
Yeah,
that's a pretty thick watch.
Yeah, but it's way too thick.
I mean, most of the luxury watches that are out there are thick.
That's why I don't wear any of them.
No, they're not thick. Yeah. They're big.
Tell me the difference.
Circumference, they're big.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
It's like you're wearing a sundial on your wrist.
Yeah. It's funny. Bigger in watches is always considered, I guess, because it's a status symbol, right? Yeah. It shouts, I'm wearing an expensive watch. I feel like Apple's kind of acknowledged that the watch is not all they had hoped it would be.
Maybe.
In fact, their sales are poor. IDC said that down 56% year
over year. Still the best-selling smartwatch, but...
No.
But, oh, it's not.
Well, okay, so this is important.
Lay it on me.
I think that what they say when they mean smartwatches versus Android Wear... If you talk about Fitbit, and Fitbit has some fitness watches,
yes,
they were up by almost the same margin that Apple was down.
Interesting.
And they're easily number one. So I think you're right. Fitness is clearly the market space, not fashion.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
They have to acknowledge, look, we understand. It looks like you're wearing a smartwatch, but think of all the things it's going to do. But I asked a runner. We had Adam Engst of Tidbits on during the event. And hey, this guy's a runner. I said, would you wear an Apple Watch? He said, no, I'm going to wear my Garmin. The runner's watch. All runners, you know, they wear runner's watches that are specifically designed. And the Apple Watch is just not, it's not specific enough to that category.
It's a general workout watch.
Yeah.
Like if you're just like GPS, me, and you're like, important. Oh, I can run around my block and right. then I'm going to go eat some french fries and maybe have a milkshake on Twit. And
that's what I do at my workouts. It's fantastic. Yeah. I'm glad we're buddies. But I was disappointed that the new edition, the waterproofing, isn't really relevant to my use case. Because even though I'm trying to work out more, I don't swim. And so...
You should swim.
Well, you could shower with it.
But and I don't know.
No, so...
You don't shower either?
I'm blind. I can't see anything without my glasses.
What about this? Well, you know what? This is fundamentally the problem with the Apple Watch is the user interface just doesn't work. It's just too hard. With a screen that small and the number of dials and buttons and functions that they're trying to get in there, it just... It's too hard to use, I think.
And this from the guy who's wearing an Android Wear watch right now, which is way more complicated.
No, it isn't. It does less.
It does less, and it's harder to use.
It's got one button. All you do is you swipe. It's really a notification thing.
Exactly. It's a notification thing.
And if you want to get to that. It doesn't ring.
And the order of the notifications isn't the same every time for different apps. It's basically just a timeline.
No, I agree with you. This is not, I'm not saying, this is the watch to get. I think smartwatches as a category probably are not.
No, but I'm not a fan of smartwatches.
You know, they're also.
I don't see a lot of people still wearing smartwatches. Oh, stop it. The whole audience is going, right?
Everyone in the audience is like, come on.
I wear them.
They got like three on.
Our audiences almost always have Apple Watches.
I'm looking forward to WatchOS 3 because it does look as though they paid attention to a lot of the criticism
they got.
It's faster, and they totally changed the user interface. Like,
and they have
that app tray now.
Slimmed it down. Yeah, they needed to.
Yeah, but I never need to get an Uber for my watch when I can't get out my phone with a better, bigger screen that's more useful. You know, that's
in some places, in some situations, you might not want to pull out your phone and calling.
Because my Apple Watch is not an indicator that I have a nice phone in my pocket at all, given that they link together.
It's all bright.
It's more
10,000
like, hey,
nit. Here, let me take this 10,000 nit display out. It's all,
so they have the display's brighter. They've doubled the processor speed.
The battery life is the same.
Yeah, they didn't talk about battery life.
Yeah. Honestly,
they probably improved the battery life, but the display's brighter. So,
when you put in GPS, if you leave the GPS on, you'll have a few hours. I think that they even say 5 hours with GPS on. So that's why they didn't talk about battery life. They don't want to say all the weasel words like, unless you use the GPS, then it's only 5 hours.
Yeah,
but it's all on the site. It's basically the same. You charge it every night. I don't have a problem with that.
I'm okay with that. I don't wear a watch in my sleep. So, you know.
What do you think of the Nike Plus watch?
It's kind of ugly.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie. Yeah. I hate to be a hater, but I mean, that band is not attractive.
Well, I wonder how many runners are going to say, well, okay, I'll give up my runner's watch from Garmin or whoever and do this. I just don't think they will.
I think this is more for...
Nike Plus has been around forever.
It's been around for
Remember, Tim Cook's on the Nike
very
board.
Popular.
There's a very close relationship between Nike and Apple.
Oh, because he's on the board.
And Apple. He's on the board. They hired Jay Blonick from Nike to do their sports fitness stuff. No, there's a very close relationship between Apple and Nike.
I think this watch isn't necessarily for the people who are super hardcore with the Garmin watches. I think this is for the people who are using the Nike app on their phone, maybe doing some running from time to time. You know, it's like, hey, here's an extension of what you're already doing. Because the Nike Plus app, as you know, has been around for years. Mm-hmm. It's very popular. You know, I think it's more for maybe someone who is serious about running, but maybe not like a Ironman triathlon person.
So it's kind of like that middle ground, like that above the person who's doing
aspirational
above us, but below like a real.
When you say above
run.
Us, you mean like we don't do anything?
And well, okay, above people who are a little bit above us, so that weird middle ground.
that's 8 people on
like
a
someone
dog.
Who like someone who they work out like 3 times a
what
week.
What do you mean?
You know, maybe they run.
Is, is 3 times a week not enough?
No, you have the regular Apple Watch. Like the person who's going to run 7 days a week, but running isn't their entire life. They don't have.
If you
like,
run 7 days a week and can do that, running is your life.
Okay.
I have to say I'm surprised because I've been baiting you guys like crazy, and you guys just are not standing up and defending Apple at all.
Oh, right.
Wait, why would I defend a company?
I think this is
I defend
also,
Robbie and my cats.
Right on.
This
right
is
on.
Also a wife. Really easy thing for them to do. The only difference really is the band. The watch itself is the same.
Right.
It looks like there might be a specific watch face that goes along with it. Which
but
is
they do that
very,
with their Mez as well.
Exactly. Right? Super, super
easy
simple.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, that band is the same fitness band. It just has the holes drilled in it.
They do have some new features. The watch will annoy you if you don't exercise sufficiently.
Because fit shaming is lovely for your mental health.
Fit shaming, that's the word, isn't it? And it does match your Beats headphones. So
okay, but if you're Apple and all you've added is waterproofing essentially to the device, what do you want to do to extend the announcement? You bring in Nike and you make a big splash out of it. I mean, literally a splash, get it?
Splash.
Actually,
come on, Nate.
What you really do is you bring in Niantic and John Hanke, the CEO of Niantic Labs, to talk about Pokemon Go.
Pokemon Go.
Honestly, I'm...
For hours.
I'm genuinely excited about that because I feel like the Apple Watch...
It's the perfect Pokemon Go
tool. It is
kind
of the perky.
It is. And you know, the Apple Watch is by far the best smartwatch you can buy. That being said, it has no killer app. It has like no thing... That you're just like, man, I need that. I wish I had that. And
I think you actually
for
nailed
some
that.
People, Pokemon Go might be that thing.
That's exactly Apple's strategy. Is we need the killer app, but we need it in all these different verticals.
Yeah.
So they're trying to find the killer app in a dozen verticals.
Yep.
And I think that maybe is enough. If you're a Pokemon Go fanatic, that might be enough to push you in. If you're a runner or a swimmer, maybe that'd push you in.
Because I mean, that's what the phone is. The phone is like. It's good for this, but it's also good for this.
No,
it's also good. I can play games on my phone.
The phone feels like more of a general purpose thing, though, than the watch.
And I think they're trying to make the watch a little bit more general purpose, like slowly.
It's a challenge.
It's hard because
UI it becomes complicated.
Well, think about it. When the iPhone first came out, the killer app was you could have email and an internet browser and maps. And then it was like
Google Maps.
Wow, there's an app store, and you have all these things. I mean, you know, the killer app was Angry Birds. The killer app was Pokemon Go a few months ago. The killer app.
Turn by turn navigation used to be a paid feature on hardware.
Yes.
When they brought that to digital.
They killed that.
Mobile browsing, mobile internet, better phone quality. I mean, the original iPhone, even sans third-party apps, was incredible.
Yeah.
And we forget that. But these are now launched with no real purpose, no real impact, so to add things to them, a glom on features and feature sets, and that's less impressive to me. Yeah. To Leo's point about them not selling very well.
Well,
I'm not shocked.
I do.
By the way, not selling well for Apple means millions.
Right. I mean,
it's only every other company in the world would be like,
I mean, it's not like people aren't buying them. Yeah,
I mean,
see a lot of them.
I do see a lot of Apple Watches on the wild. I mean, I travel pretty regularly for work and for some professional organizations I'm in and things like that. And I see a lot of people wearing these things in airports.
Do you?
All
right.
It always surprises me.
I see way more Apple Watches than, let's say, I don't know, Windows phones.
You never see Windows phones.
R.I.P. Lumia.
I'll grant you that. Yeah. Well, I'm gonna, you know,
I do want to give.
I give it another try with a Series 2. I have a I have a one, not even a Series 1. I have the original Apple Watch. Yeah.
Yeah.
I do want to give Apple a little bit of props, though. I know you guys might totally slam me for this, but they didn't change the look of the Apple Watch with the Series 2.
The
bands still work, all that stuff. And with the iPhone 7, it's the same length, width, and thickness as the iPhone 6 and 6S. And we basically slam all of these companies, we being like tech press in general, not just the people seated here, for making thinner phones and not increasing battery life and not doing these things. I think it's kind of nice to see a company just like keep a little bit of sameness, but add some things in the process.
I think that's what you're going to see from now on.
Yeah,
frankly.
I think people are saying
next year the 10th anniversary iPhone. Apple's got to start to slow that speculation down because what could they do that would make this 10th anniversary phone be wow, what an improvement. There's nothing more. Yeah.
They can put a keyboard on it.
Wireless charging.
Wireless charging would
incredible.
Be
great. No, but not just wireless, but really good wireless charging.
Everybody like fast charging except Apple has wireless charging.
That would be incredible. It's slow, though. It's not very good.
And the problem is you can't make a metal phone with wireless charging.
You can make a heavy metal phone with wireless charging. Boom.
Ooh, rock and roll.
Sorry, that's for Robbie.
But you know, there's another thing that's happening on the consumer side, which is we're holding on to our phones longer, you know, and the
because we're paying data real prices, we're not seeing how much it actually costs.
But I think that's also good too. I think you know the idea of tech companies, and hey, Wall Street would love this, but tech companies forcing us into buying a new phone every year. That's just that's not a good idea for us.
And,
it's not
and
a
Apple's
cost effective.
It's not good for e-waste. Not doing that. Although Apple does have that deal where you can pay monthly and get
they
a
do
new
have
phone
that.
Every
but
year.
Then they refurbish your phone and they sell those again.
Yeah.
So
no, I think that's appropriate.
So I think keeping those things going, that's better for the environment. That's better for tech companies. It's better for us. You know, so I think in the long run, this could all be really good stuff.
Yeah. You guys didn't even mention the best feature about the Apple Watch, the squirting speaker.
Oh yeah, it squirts. I made an inappropriate joke on Twitter about it.
I'm shocked.
Everybody made an inappropriate joke on Twitter about it.
So the speaker squirts out the water. You get out of the pool and it's all, and it squirts out the water.
I mean, that's the main reason I bought one. I just can't wait to see what that looks like.
Okay, you got to get some colored.
I don't think it's actually
water.
It's not gonna like know that you're standing and suddenly they just like
yes.
What?
It's like you shake your ear.
No. You know, you shake your ear after you go surfing or something.
So they said, as I remember, they said, look, here's the one problem with waterproofing a watch is the speaker. You can't have a working speaker that doesn't let water in. So we've solved this problem by creating a speaker that ejects the water when you get out of the water. So it knows when you get out of the water.
It knows
when
you
get out of the water. And then the speaker must do a little... It must make
sound effects are not important here.
I think that sound effects
are make a sound.
Also, if you go back in history to the original Zunes, they had a feature that sent
they
songs
squirted.
Back and forth.
That's
yeah.
different. That was squirting audio. Not
like
when
it
was
also.
They called it that. They called it squirting audio. The Zunes.
Yeah, I remember Steve Ballmer said.
Why
that
would
you
they squirt?
Choose?
No.
Yeah.
Because they're old.
Oh God, yeah. Microsoft.
So I'm thinking it's just they play a sound that vibrates the water out of there. But maybe there's a special ejection mechanism.
I hope it's like a fart noise. So there's a little water salt. Guys,
do you see why I had to buy one?
No.
Yeah, that's kind of that's actually the killer feature. You're just like, look at this, guys. You put your hand in a bucket of water.
I will get the AirPods as soon as those are available because I think that's going to be interesting.
October,
it's going to be
right.
frustrating as hell. You're going to hate them. You're going to lose them.
The ear things?
You know, I wonder if Apple's going to sell like a lanyard, you know, like you'd wear for your,
you know what
your
it'd
glasses,
be cool?
But for the headphones.
So if it was a lanyard and so it wouldn't get lost, the lanyard was like attached to your phone?
You're just quoting Johnny's son now.
You're awesome. That's great.
That's a great idea.
You stole that tweet in real life.
I did. I stole it. Right. I don't know who said it, but.
if you just have some sort of attachment that you can put on the phone.
If you
can
attach to your phone.
If you drop the AirPods.
Like you could drill a hole in it and just shove it
just
in there
put
so
it, like, in
like
there.
It would anchor it.
Yeah. That's a great idea.
Troll.
Now that's innovation.
In a couple of years, I'll probably actually make audio go through that lanyard hole.
Honestly,
for higher fidelity.
No, yeah. No, now you're now you're crazy talk.
Higher.
Yeah, maybe it could even help you charge the headphones.
Ooh. Cameron, do we want to say anything about the camera? No, let's take a break. We'll talk about the camera when we come back. It's not the first phone with dual cameras. Somebody had an LG G5 in here yesterday. Did exactly the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Two lenses, wide and telephoto. You have a button on the screen, switches back and forth. It's been done. But
yes.
Apple did it again, and this time they got it right. Our show... Our show today. I don't hate Apple. I buy everything they make. I don't hate them.
I don't think anyone said anyone.
I think I completely crystallized my point of view earlier in the show when I said you want them to be the company that they were for so many years, the innovator, changing the world, and then it's hard as a journalist to look at what they've done and decide, is that going to change the world or is that just a profit-making machine designed to squeeze money out of us.
Well, you know, there's only some like most companies in the existence of the world have maybe changed the world zero times.
That's true.
Or
that's
if
true.
You're lucky once.
No, they
right?
have an amazing track record.
And you could argue that Apple kind of did that with the Mac.
Yeah.
Definitely did that with the iPod, and it's done with the iPhone. and maybe-ish the iPad, right? No. So even if you take that away, let's say Alex, how many times would you say, like, the iPhone and what else?
Oh, no, iPhone, iPod, Mac. I think OS 10 was huge.
Okay, so you give them four.
OS 10 was huge.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know what? Next year, and they're not talking about it. By the way, I guess they're going to have another event because they didn't say anything about anything but iPhones and Apple.
In the past, they've had October.
They're
going to
have an October event. They got to do iPad event. They got to do MacBooks.
Yeah,
yeah. They got to get the iPads ready for the holidays.
They didn't mention the rumored 5K cinema display.
My point is Apple's already changed many things, revolutionized many things. I hate using these words, but way more than almost any other company.
And next year, as I was saying, they're going to do the Apple file system, the new APIs, which is, frankly,
huge.
Going to be the first time mainstream users have had access to the kind of file system technology others have had with ZFS and BTFS.
Yeah,
BTRFS.
But, I mean, they can't do this every
year.
That's
going to be huge. You know, users are going to go, "Wow, my data is I don't lose data anymore." It's going
to
be big.
I think to your point, the last thing I'll say is we shouldn't have to have a brand new, complete new phone every year.
Yes.
But if the price is going to persist at the exact same price point or go up, I guess it did this time, then I do have expectations. I thought the SP went up by 20 or 40. Am I wrong?
No, I think it's the same.
Price. Well,
They don't have a 16 gig version anymore, but the 32 gig version is still $649.
Same price. Yeah.
What was the 16 gigabyte one before?
$649.
Okay. Yeah. All right, cool. Well, good for them then.
So you're a little more
I retract the complaint.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. You know, and their competitors, you know, their competitors are making things that are very similar, that are maybe a little bit more accessible, a little more
affordable. Let's talk about
affordable.
The Note 7 when we come back, because I would love to talk about
that. On a commercial break.
I want to talk about right now eggplant and chickpea tagine with Islander pepper, tomato, and couscous. How about that for dinner?
Yeah.
Do you like that tonight? I'm cooking.
I don't like eggplant.
Okay.
Says the vegetarian.
No. Oh, you're a vegetarian? How about summer udon noodle salad with cherry tomatoes, corn, and summer sweet pepper?
I love udon.
Spicy. Udon is so underrated. Ramen gets all the props.
I know. Udon is good. It's a good noodle.
I tell people.
How about spicy hoisin chicken stir fry with baby bok choy and sesame ginger cucumber salad? This is what's in my Blue Apron box this week. Blue Apron delivers a box to me every week, refrigerated with fresh meats, vegetables, the best stuff from local farms, and in it, every exact ingredient I need and not one more. If I need one clove of garlic, it's got one clove of garlic. There's no waste. And then it's got a recipe card and I can cook this meal, and it's amazing. It's amazing. Blue Apron, their mission is to make incredible home cooking accessible to everyone while supporting a more sustainable food system, setting the highest standards for ingredients. And to me, this is the most important, building a community of home chefs. I know it's hard. You get home from work. You've been working all day. Last thing you want to do is plan a meal, shop for a meal, come home and cook the meal. So when you got that Blue Apron box on your doorstep and it's there and you're going to make this amazing meal in 40 minutes, you're going to be eating, everybody's going to say, "This is incredible. I never had anything so good." You're going to use ingredients that you've never used before, like udon. You're going to say, "Oh, no more ramen for me. I got udon, baby." And the next time, you'll know how to cook it. So it's like a cooking class in a box. I love Blue Apron. And by the way, this will cost you less than shopping for yourself because they don't have the brick and mortars. They don't have the clerks. It's 60% more expensive to buy at a grocery store than to go to Blue Apron. And it's a lot less expensive than buying a lesser meal at a restaurant. You got to stop going to In-N-Out, guys. You got to get Blue Apron. So let me recommend it and tell you how you can get three meals free if you go to blueapron.com/twit. Take a look at the menu. You get to pick what you're going to have. Korean, I love Korean pork tacos. Love them. Ooh, see, when I look at the menus and I see what they've got, I'm thinking, I got to have that. It's so good. And it's fun to make it yourself, and the house smells great. Go to blueapron.com/twit. You're going to love how good it feels, how it tastes, to create incredible home-cooked meals with Blue Apron. And your first three meals are free with free shipping. They're delivered to 99% of the continental United States. I'm sorry, Alaska. Nope, no Blue Apron for you. blueapron.com/twit. We thank them so much for their support of our show and for making amazing meals. I chickened out. I was gonna brave it out. This is courage. I was going to keep my Note 7 and continue to use it.
Oh.
living on the wild side.
You're gonna wear like oven mitts and like.
It never got hot. I quick charged it. Nothing went wrong. Well, I thought I'm just gonna keep it, but then I got scared because, first of all, the airlines start saying, "Well, you can't fly with that thing."
Yeah.
Yeah,
in Australalia, the FAA.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're not. Yeah. Once the airline's like, you can't take this thing on the plane, you're like, oh, well, nope.
Now, Samsung says only one in, I've heard two numbers, 32,000 or one in 41,000 phones have this bad battery. It's, by the way, ironic because Samsung was outsourcing the battery to a Chinese company. Those were fine. It's the one Samsung made themselves, apparently, that have the problem. But it's only a total out of 2.5 million. What is 2.5 million divided by 42,000? Anybody?
You.
Anybody?
It's like 45.
It's like a few hundred, right?
Wait,
come on.
You already had 35 incidents.
2.5 million?
2.5 million divided by 41,000.
Nine. No, it's 61.
61. So there've already been 35 fires.
Mm-hmm. There's only 26 left.
There's only 26 left.
Countdown, what are the chances? Explosion.
Could it be you?
It's literally
3, 2, 1, Samsung.
It's literally 1 in 250,000 that I'd have one of those phones.
But knowing your luck, you wouldn't.
Aww. Well, the other thing is I'm going on vacation next week. I'm getting in not only planes, but I'm getting on a cruise ship where I will have to charge that phone. And if the cruise ship burnt to the ground...
To the sea.
You'd feel bad. Yeah. You'd feel bad.
To the sea.
I would feel pretty bad.
If it burnt to the ground, that would be impressive.
It would burn the entire ocean away as well.
It's all...
So I chickened out. And by the way, I've read Christina Warren's pieces at...
Gizmodo?
Yeah, I was almost said Mashable at Gizmodo now.
Oh,
where she's
right.
saying it's a real mess, people returning. But I got it from T-Mobile, brought it to T-Mobile. The guy looked at the back and said, well, you know, this one was made in China, so the chances are it is not one of the problem phones. I said, are you recommending I not turn it in? He said, no, you should turn it in.
Yeah.
And they just credited my credit card, the full $850.
Oh, they didn't give you like a loaner or something like that?
Well, you have a choice. It depends on your carrier, but I think in most cases you can either turn it in and then when they get new Note 7s. By the way, the new Note 7s apparently have a sticker with an S for safe on them.
Oh, man. That
so
is
it
not
a sticker
what you want
or are they
going
to like actually like
right on
engrave
the back.
It? Because it'd be cool if it was like engraved on the back. Like, this is
blue,
such a
this is
like,
safe. Well, they have
so
they, maybe
so
they do because can you
get on
an airplane?
A plane, you're like,
how
do
you
mean
know?
To your phone? You're like,
no,
oh,
I have
it's
the
got,
safe. It's safe.
Yeah, I got the Star Barely Sneech.
Just get a Sharpie and some, you know, just draw it yourself.
Yeah.
So you could do that, or, which I suspect no one will do. If you want, you can get in some cases a Galaxy S7, in some cases a cheesy Samsung phone loaner until the Note 7 comes out. Not a good one. Or you can get your money back.
It's like a flip phone.
Samsung's offering a $25 credit to anybody who does this, so you get some compensation. I bought a cheap case, so that would be nice.
It's but they were. Like, what are you
I
use,
have to
you
know? Give them credit. They did the right thing. They stepped up, right? Eventually, they even contacted the CPSC and made an official recall.
They did a very good job on the recall and a very bad job leading up to that by making the mistake. So my real curiosity is, will this cost their brand long term?
I think so.
Because the short-term financial impact we can just measure. But I'm curious about the long-term loss of brand equity and therefore lost future sales.
Well, how many people are going to turn it in and then say, I'll take another one?
Are you?
You got to think about... Remember?
No, you know what I'm doing? I'm buying an iPhone.
Remember right? My man.
Power Mac or Power Books were catching on fire. The 5300
This
series.
Has happened. To Apple, it's happened to iPhones, it's happened to PowerBooks, it's happened to Toshiba, it's happened to Dell.
Did that hurt them? They were already in a bad shape at that point during the 90s, but did that hurt them even more?
But they sold 2.5 million Note 7s. This was the flagship Samsung phone.
Oh, yeah.
You've seen very graphic
video. So you have 2.5 million people like...
I think this is
going to the mall. No one wants to go to the mall.
There's the initial cost, which is estimated to be $1.5 billion. Mm-hmm. And then I think there's long-term costs. I even think there's long-term costs to lithium-ion battery technology.
Well, there's nothing to replace that right now.
Yeah,
in the
lithium. Yeah, they're.
But look,
on
you know,
everything.
I think this coming on the hoverboard thing.
Yeah.
Now this is a 1-2 punch. People are thinking, should I bring these things into my house? These are dangerous. You think people will just go, well, I got to live with it.
I think it's going to come down to what compelling devices other companies come
no
out
choice.
With. Right?
I think it's going
to
be awesome.
I'm driving a giant bomb with a ton of lithium ion.
So that's the thing. I think it's going to be awesome fodder for the 6 o'clock news, like local 6 o'clock
it
news.
Has been.
What thing in your house will explode because of lithium ion batteries? Tune in at 6 p.m.
Yes,
when
it's true.
Well, but ion. If you just know how batteries work in general, like,
it's dangerous. If they're punctured, they
exactly,
can catch
exactly.
on fire.
All of these things can catch on fire if you do it the right way, right? So, I think the issue really comes down to, you know, like, how quickly is Samsung going to bring out these new phones that work and repair it? Because it's taken a while. I mean, they had their voluntary recall. Then they talked to all the carriers. Then the FAA came out and did their thing. The Australian Airlines Authority banned the phones. And now they're working with the CPSC on an official recall. So they kind of got out a little bit ahead of it. But at the same time, it's starting to drag out. And now what we're hearing is not just that it's been recalled, but now that there's another authority, another body that you should be listening to that is also saying, yeah, by the way, take that phone back if you haven't already. Yeah, by the way, don't want to take that on an airplane. Don't charge it. Don't use it. I mean, it's just kind of being compounded.
Wasn't hysteria? If only 68 phones in the whole world had this problem.
Yes.
I felt really confident that my Note 7 was fine. I'm sure you'll be fine. I was sure I was fine. But the minute the airline said, "Well, you can't get," I mean, they're literally telling people at the gate, "If you have a Note 7, you may not put it in your checked luggage. You must carry it on. You must not turn it on. You must not charge it."
Well, if they would have known that 68 of them leaving the factory weren't in good shape, when they all left with the quality checks, they all looked to be legit. They have quality checks in place. When they're building these devices.
Well, that's why it's probably such a small number, right?
Probably.
They're going to have, they say, an IMEI database where people will be able to look up their phone.
Exactly. But if you're the FAA, the question is, oh, it was only 68, it's probably not going to happen. It's like, if one of those things goes off
in a
plane.
I don't want it to be me. I know.
Exactly.
I know.
Like, it's not.
Or
it's
take
so,
out a plane, kill 300 people, and all of a sudden Samsung's phone kills, you know.
Exactly. So all it takes is one in the right place to go off.
I feel,
and I mean, then it's a big problem.
Okay,
I'm disappointed because I actually love the phone.
It's a really
great
nice phone.
Phone.
It's one of the best phones Samsung's ever
made.
And
I'm probably not going to get another one.
So I went ahead and pulled the math and did the currency conversions to figure this out. But 1.5. that's where I went for two minutes.
That's his job.
He's like, hold on, everybody, I got math.
I haven't actually verified this yet, so don't get mad. It's about 2% of their ready cash right now is $1.5 billion. So the loss here from a gross cash perspective. From a gross cash view, yes, they can. But it's still enough money. It's going to screw up a lot of divisions' operating profits, and it's going to look very bad. So the short-term financial impact, doable, long-term brand, I leave to Robbie.
Well, it
buy,
could,
sell,
it
or hold.
This could Metallica. Be like the Ford Pinot for Samsung. It's like a punchline.
You know what?
It's going to take a good example.
There's a good example.
It might take a few years for them to sort of like get
really
it back.
Hurt Ford. People still talk about that. That really hurt Ford.
Well, only like people my age and older.
Right. How old are you, Robbie?
I'm 57.
Aside from that.
57? I'm 9, so, you know.
You're both terrible liars.
Is 57 old?
No. Yes. Anything over 23 is old.
Yes. That's correct.
Answer. That's true. Answer. Anything over 23 is old. If you're 27 and you're like, I'm still young, you're a liar. Someone's lied to you.
I'm 27.
Society has lied to you. You're old.
They told me that 57 was the new 37.
Yeah, those people lied.
It's all right.
Just be happy at what age you are.
But yeah, like,
I made it.
I love how mad they are in
it's
chat.
Better than the alternative.
What? He's not 57.
They believe
this guy's 27.
They believe
how old do you guys think I am?
Careful.
Oh, he's 32.
I think it's going to be a black eye for Samsung, and it's going to be a black eye for
quite a while. Nate's like,
we're going on tangents here. Stick to the script, guys. Samsung.
This is like third grade. I'm going to be shouted out by a teacher. Don't eat crayons.
I'm sad about it.
It's a bummer.
It's a couple years.
It's a bad thing for Samsung.
Yeah, it's a couple years of Samsung being the butt of a lot of jokes.
Yeah. But it might be an opportunity for LG or Huawei or
it's an opportunity to make a comeback. It's no accident that the exact amount of money you get back at T-Mobile is what it would cost to say, well, I'll take an iPhone instead. You got to think that a lot of those
people
are going
to
have
this right now. They have to love this.
Oh, this is totally perfect for them because what took the air out of all the complaints that we were making? This saga is huge.
Yeah.
And now, as Robbie said, Samsung is the peach emoji of the smartphone world.
Yeah. Yeah, they're going to. Yeah. You know what? I don't have a headphone port, but it's not going to blow up in my hand.
Yeah, I'll get the jokes. Yeah. I turned around the emoji. Yeah. I don't know.
As long as you don't say it's the eggplant.
I
know my emojis, buddy.
There you
go. Just because I'm in my 50s.
You're more hip than I am and always have been.
Yeah.
Logan, I'm not worried about it.
We had a great week on Twit talking about all this stuff, and we have a little mini movie we made just for your delectation in case you missed a minute. Watch.
Previously on Twit.
thinking about doing something nutty. I don't know if you heard Windows Weekly earlier, but Mary Jo Foley convinced me maybe not to bring any technology
this
with me.
This did not last very long.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
You sound skeptical. Windows Weekly. Could Microsoft have won the mobile market?
The Apple envy that drove Microsoft during this period of time was so strong that they literally followed Apple down this consumer rabbit hole and tried to make a consumer product. After they had failed with Zune, after they had failed with Windows Media Center, they still tried. And that is astonishing to me.
Security Now.
Yaw Titty, yet another way to track you. It is now possible for a web page to determine the exact color and amount of light which your phone is exposed to. If that's code running in an ad, and you then go from one site to another, oh, you know, we weren't sure if this was the same guy, but look, exactly the same amount of red, green, and blue probably is.
Twit, now in color.
Oh, I tell you.
I don't know why they made laughs.
Oh, I tell you, Steve Gibson, he's a wild one. Let's see what's coming up the week ahead.
Hey, thanks, Leo. Here are a few things that we'll be keeping a close eye on in the week ahead. Starting Monday, September 12th, TechCrunch Disrupt kicks off in San Francisco. And I'll actually be there with a crew, with Kara, of course, and a few others, chatting with some of the startups and innovators who are showing off their hard work at the event. Also on the 12th, Google will officially discontinue its Google Plus Hangouts on Air service. But have no fear, creators can transition over to YouTube Live relatively easy and keep their live streams going over there. On Tuesday, September 13th, Apple will unleash its updated iOS 10 to salivating fans the world over. On Thursday, September 15th, Sony is launching its newly announced PS4 Slim for $299, which is nearly identical to its full-size brethren, along with an updated DualShock 4 controller and redesigned light bar. And on Friday, September 16th, let the reign of new Apple devices commence as the big kahuna, the Apple iPhone 7 series, begins shipping to those who've pre-ordered their own new favorite toy. As well, Apple will be selling its new Apple Watch Series 2 and launching the updated Watch OS 3 for owners of the original model. So many toys, so little time. You know that Megan Maroney and I will talk about all this stuff and a whole lot more all week on Tech News Today, so don't miss it. That's a look at the week ahead. Back to you, Leo.
Thank you, Jason. We'll do an unboxing of the gold iPhone on Friday.
You sound so disappointed.
Well, we can look at the camera. Two cameras, one wide angle, 28 millimeter effective, one 56 millimeter, which is not telephoto, but it's twice as close. And then Apple said, and as extra credit, you're going to have bokeh in the new camera, but it won't be till later.
Like, yeah,
we're still working on that.
It looks like it could be cool.
It looks pretty
nice. We won't know until later.
It's faux. We call it foca.
It's foca.
Yeah.
But still looks pretty nice.
I wish I could give credit to whoever came up with that term. Foca. It's really good. Our show today brought to you by Audible.com. If you like, if you're like me, you like reading. I tell you, I didn't read as much as I would like to once you get out of college and you start working for a living, you don't have as much time, you get home, you want to read, you're sleepy, you go to sleep, the book falls on your nose, it hurts, you never do that again. Then along came Audible, and I had a lot of time in the car every day, I was commuting, and Audible books meant that the 2 hours I spent in the car every day, it was 2 hours of reading, and it changed my life. I've been an Audible subscriber since the year 2000, and I've got hundreds of books on my virtual Audible shelf. I invite you to give Audible a try. It really is a fantastic place to get audio entertainment. Fiction and nonfiction, college courses, they have the great courses, which are phenomenal. That really makes you feel like you're learning something. I love that. They've got comedy performances. They've got speeches. There's a lot of audio content waiting for you at audible.com. You can buy it a la carte, but the best way, the way I do it, and the way I've done it ever since the year 2000, is by subscription. You can get, I have the 2 books a month subscription. Actually, it's kind of nice because I don't often get to 2 books a month, but I have kind of a backlog. And then when I go on a trip, I've got stuff to read. I'm pretty excited about that. Somebody suggested that I read Bulgarin before I go to Russia. So I'm reading The Master and the Margarita, which is a classic Russian novel. It's quite good. And because I'm listening to it on Audible, I'm also getting the benefit of a really good reader who's bringing the book to life. And with Russian names, that's helpful because that's sometimes a little confusing. You may not know whether you're ready for audiobooks. I think a lot of people think, well, I don't know if I could I listen to a book and really understand it and hear it. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to give you two books free. I'll give you a chance to see what you think. Whether you're reading a tech book like the Steve Jobs biography, actually several on audible.com that I've read and are really, really good. I think Becoming Steve Jobs is the one I'd recommend. Or funny books, John Hodgman and Amy Poehler. And I love those. And often when it's a comic, the comics will read those. And it's just like getting a performance in your car. Here's the deal. Go to audible.com/twit2. You're going to sign up. You're going to be signing up for the Platinum Plan. That's my plan, which is two books a month. But the first month is free. So you can get those two books and cancel anytime in the first 30 days, but you can keep them. You'll also get the Daily Digest of the Wall Street Journal or the New York Times. If you drive, if you work out at the gym, mostly for me now it's at the gym or taking walks. I like to listen to audiobooks. Audible is awesome. Go to audible.com/twit and the number 2 to get your two books free. audible.com/twit and the number 2. The offer is good in the U.S. and Canada, but if you're outside that area, we have lots of Australians in the studio audience today, don't worry, Audible's there too. Hello. And a great, by the way, you got a son, your son is with you, a young adult. Research shows that young adults and children who listen to audiobooks read sooner and read more. You might think, oh, they're not going to read because they're listening, but it gets them excited about books. So whenever my kids had a reading assignment, we'd always get the audiobook. Whenever we went on a family trip, we'd always get an audiobook, and it's a great way to be together, to listen, to talk about fiction, nonfiction. It's fun. Audible.com/twit2. Give it a try today. Your first two free at Audible. I guess October 4th, Google's going to have an announcement. Is it? Are we done? I mean, is it like, oh, Pixel, whatever, Nexus? Do we care?
I still care, but
I mean, I like really the idea. I'm when it comes to Android, any Android device that gets an update as soon as it's
well,
ready.
That's really a good point.
That's
now.
the only Android device I want to get.
Yeah,
I don't want to get
think
like
that's the compelling reason to not buy anything but Google devices.
Yeah,
but Nexus devices
because you know you have stage fright, you have all these security issues,
there's a terrible one.
Yeah, the new one with the what was it the
Ars Technica was writing about it. It's actually kind of scary. It's a they're not only are they malicious, they're critical bugs, but there are already apps in the App Store discovered that take advantage of them. Now, whenever Google discovers these, of course, they remove from the App Store. But the fact that they got into the App Store, and they estimate as many as 2.5 million people have downloaded malicious apps.
Wow.
And even if you have a Nexus, you're not protected because the patch for this comes out in the September update, which is, I should check, but I've been checking all day, is not out yet. So I have a 6P. If you have a 5X or 6P, even with a Google phone, you're vulnerable to this bug, which was discovered by Google. It allows attackers to execute malware or escalate local privileges on vulnerable phones. By the way, every Android device in existence is currently vulnerable, except for the ones inside Google that got the September patch already. It can be exploited in a large variety of ways, including sending you a JPEG. So a bad guy could text you a JPEG. Hey, here's a picture.
Oh, okay.
Here's Roberto Baldwin as you've never seen him before.
And you're going to click on that.
Who wouldn't click on that? Yeah, and you open it and boom.
Boom.
You're bad. You could also embed it in an MP4 file. There's all sorts of ways to do this. So it's the EXIF data in the image can contain the vulnerability. It is a really, really bad one. Now, I have to point out Apple had a similarly bad vulnerability last month. Any operating system is going to have bugs. And people are working. There's a lot of money to be made, as we know now. That Israeli group that made millions of dollars selling an
exploit
iOS.
Merchants are living the dream.
So that means they're working hard to find the next $500,000 bug, right?
Yeah.
Or $1 million bug.
Zerodium had the $1 million bounty for an iOS bug.
Yeah.
And they said they paid it.
Not because they're going to tell Apple.
No. Yeah.
They're going to sell it.
They're going to sell it to nation states and some of the more
horrible,
nefarious, merchants, exploit merchants are going to sell it to whoever. They'll sell it to other companies. They'll sell it to, you know, maybe some nations that have a pretty scary human rights track record.
You know, I think you're at this point, you're just hoping that nobody's going after you. But here's an example. The one of the exploits is called Call Jam, and it was embedded into an app called Gems Chest for Clash Royale. Clash Royale is a best-selling game.
I presume Gems Chest is not actually an official game?
No. It's you know, one of those things where here you get some free gems for your Clash Royale.
Yeah, pro tip, don't do that, by the way.
Don't do that. You should know better, but 100,000 to 500,000 people fell for it.
Yep.
Now, of course, immediately, as soon as Google finds out about this, they remove them. Google also has a scanner on your Android device that scans for known exploits. So I'm hoping the people didn't get bit by this. Yeah. But Dress Code, which is another exploit, was used probably to generate fraudulent clicks on ads, but it could be used in a more malicious way.
Because if it's pushing you to click on something, that means it could push on you to click on something that
absolutely
has malware. Yeah. The malware gets installed on your phone, and now
get this: 40 Google Play apps containing Dress Code downloaded from 500,000 to 2 million times.
Yeah.
Wow. Super bad.
This does happen on every operating system, like you mentioned, but on the mobile side, at least, it happens on Android a lot more than happens on iOS. And Google's really good about addressing things quickly, but because there are so many Android devices out there, and because so few get the software updates from Google,
yes,
it's just a major problem. Unless the safest thing you can do as an Android user is using a Nexus device, is using a Google device. Samsung and BlackBerry have been keeping up with some of their updates
both
a little
Samsung
quicker.
Both Samsung and LG Motorola have supposedly committed, and this is what I think you're going to look for, committed to taking the monthly security updates.
Yes.
So you're probably okay with Samsung and LG. Surprisingly, Motorola has not yet committed. There are a lot of really nice, inexpensive phones like the Axon 7, mm-hmm. the OnePlus 3, mm-hmm. the new Honor 8 from Huawei. None of those companies have agreed to take the updates. Doesn't mean they won't, it's just they're not committing to. So at this point, I think you go with it was called Nexus, I guess it's going to be called Pixel, but you go with a Google phone because at least you know they'll get it before anybody else does.
And, you know, it's I feel like it's something that not a lot of folks, you know, realize. And of course, it's a matter of taste, but I feel like the Nexus devices with unaltered Android, it's always the best Android user experience.
It's a good experience from a software point of view, but they're rarely better. as good a hardware as Samsung and others make.
That's
right?
Totally fair. That's totally fair. Software matters to me, and Samsung's getting a lot better with it. In previous years, I couldn't stand their versions of Android.
Right.
Now I think, you know, they're getting pretty good.
No, it's pretty light. And so the Axon is, the OnePlus 3 is. But and arguably, certainly the Samsung has better hardware than anything Google's been putting on. The new phones are apparently being designed by HTC to Google's specifications. I really hope Google offers this as a flagship phone, even if it's a flagship price.
Mm-hmm.
I hope they don't try to do a $350 or $400 price point.
You don't want to see two? Because, I mean, the 6P was kind of that.
But do a really nice one.
But one needs to have the best, as good a camera as everybody else.
Yeah.
Fast storage as everyone else. Google, unfortunately, is kind of committed to not doing micro SD cards. I think that's a mistake. Apple doesn't do it either, but Samsung and everybody else offers SD cards. So I would love to see Google say, all right, we're going to make a $700 phone that is top of the line. That's the pure Android phone, and that's the one we hope people would buy. If they did that, I would be very happy, but unfortunately,
going to war with your OEMs is always incredibly risky.
Right.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, Microsoft learned this post-Nokia.
Yeah.
And how well did that work out? We made the joke earlier. I mean, I think to do that would require being able to say we are willing to lose OEM partners to do this ourselves.
The problem is, where do OEMs go? There is no other phone operating system.
And I don't know how.
Tizen.
I mean,
kidding.
Tizen.
I'm kidding. Everyone, whoa, calm down.
I think there's no accident that Samsung is developing its own operating system.
It is a plan C in back pocket.
Yeah. Well, it's been a plan C for a few years.
It'll stay that way.
Their software is. Skills are so far behind that.
Yeah, you can just say it's junk if you want.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's junk. I think it's all right.
Junky. I mean, but there's also the concern. I mean, if you're a user and you buy a Nexus phone or you buy any Android phone, you go to the Google Play Store, you're like, well, these are all going to be safe because I hear about people in China who are using third-party stores and they're getting malware installed. Google really needs to step up its policing of the Google
Play
Store.
Maybe that's true, too. That's the other side.
I mean, if if I mean, it got downloaded 2.5 million times.
That's amazing. Yeah.
That's I mean, 2.5 million times people got this before Google's like, oh, damn.
Well, they have a different Google has a different process than Apple does in terms of getting apps into their app store, and they're a little less stringent. Basically, you can submit an app. There are some computer-generated scans that are done, but in most cases, people aren't actually looking at the apps themselves. And you know, there's a lot of stuff that that software can do to check an app to see whether it's safe or not.
Yeah.
But of course, when these sorts of exploits exist and they're not known, that's when that problem happens. So I've actually done some reporting on this in the past, and Google says they're trying to step these sorts of things up. But they simply just let in a lot more apps than Apple does, and they do so without less human, with fewer people looking at it. And it's
a tough time to stem, though. I mean, even Apple can't do it perfectly.
Even Apple can't do it perfectly.
And in some ways, maybe the problem with Apple's method is it gives you a false sense of security, right?
Yeah, I mean,
at least with the Google Store, you know you're screwed.
Yeah.
Well, you should always be careful. Okay, first of all,
don't download the Clash of Clans box of gems.
Don't download third-party apps for, like, Instagram or Snapchat or Game or, you know, any of... Just get the, you know, I like Snapchat. Don't get Snapchat Junior.
Yeah, no, that's
that'll
the best
help
advice.
You do so. No, just don't get any of these weird third-party apps from companies you've never heard of, because most of the time they're just sort of, they're fishing for
ads. Janky, they're bad.
A lot of them are just ad generators for, you know, they're ad clicking.
And a lot of those apps don't make it into Apple's App Store. A lot of those
Apple has its share of crap apps.
Yeah. They do, but... far fewer than Google Play does.
You know, the worst, of course, is the Windows Phone Store. It's just...
that's just...
It's so horrible.
Oh.
It's
just... Well, but they don't have a choice.
Crap apps in because
they let everybody in
the first place.
They're hoping somebody will
Instagram was still... it probably still says Instagram Beta, the Instagram app on Windows Phone.
Sure it does. Yeah. That's a sad story, isn't it?
Oh, man. We've gone from options to...
I want to go back to college, kids, because guess what? Virginia Tech... is going to be getting a drone delivery of burritos from Chipotle. Let me say that again, in case that, you know, that sounded too far-fetched. Drone deliveries of Chipotle burritos to students at Virginia Tech, thanks to Google.
Is that a form of punishment that they have to eat Chipotle?
You had us until Chipotle.
I was
going to
say that.
But it sounds super cool.
Chipotle?
Yeah, exactly. It's like if there was like beer deliveries via drone, I'm totally
down. Chipotle is just not a good
burrito. Now, let's stop for a second. If I lived in Virginia, that might be the best burrito I'm going to get.
Pro tip, don't move to Virginia.
That's heartbreaking.
So when I lived in Kansas City, the best burrito I got was at Taco Bell.
This is why I don't live in Virginia.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, get ready. Listen to how this works. Project Wing... we'll use it. We got video,
they
right?
Could have had a much cooler name than Project Wing.
Come on. We'll use.
Could have been Dark Wing.
Actually, if you're going to do Project Wing, you should deliver Chinese food, but that's another thing entirely.
Or Hot Wings. God.
Or Hot Wings. We'll use self guided hybrids that can fly like a plane or hover like a helicopter. They will go from the Chipotle food truck to hover over the student and lower the Chipotle burrito with a winch.
So this is so ridiculous. Like, college kids need to make some money. Let those kids deliver burritos to each other on bikes and get a tip.
Okay, don't move. Stay right there. Okay.
My burrito winch is coming. Hold on.
All right. God. I know this is a family-friendly show, so I'm going to phrase it delicately, but how high would you have to be to have that sound like a good idea? I would have to be levitating in my own shoes. Oh my gosh, the burrito.
Here comes
the
Chipotle drone, dude.
Also,
I went to art school twice, so literally everyone's high all the time. It's just me and a couple thousand high students.
Will they deliver us to your window? Like, can you like slide open your window and like go arm with the
anywhere
burrito,
you
like,
can stand?
I may actually eat a Chipotle burrito if I could not get off the couch at all and it was brought into my hands.
The burrito bearing, this story, by the way, is from Bloomberg.
It's
the burrito bearing aircraft will be flown by automation, but human pilots will be standing by to take control if necessary.
I can't wait for the crazy problems that come with this.
The
like,
fast food drone.
Well, that's how we're slamming into a wall or like hitting a kid. Yeah.
Here's one. FAA rules prohibit drones flying over people. So please parse this sentence. Participants will be shielded.
What? With what?
Oh, they'll have those little like
a burrito shield.
A burrito shield.
What? You're going to have...
Well, okay, so sign up. Here's what's probably going to happen. You're going to sign up to be the person who gets a burrito delivered to you. Then, you'll get a little package, and in that package will be an umbrella.
Shield. Yes, it's your burrito.
So does it's your burrito umbrella.
I want the umbrella to be like, to be tinfoil
in
like,
case
you know,
of catastrophic burrito loss. Burrito's
covered in, and yeah, it wraps it's it up. Gotta match.
Also for the conspiracy theorists.
But honestly, given how much I don't like Chipotle burritos,
it's
I'm
not
stoked
a good
that
idea,
they're starting with Chipotle to like right. suss this out because there's gonna be lots of like.
Every wasted drops. Chipotle
steak
burrito
and drops. There's gonna be lots of burritos that die
and no quality
and never
lost.
Make it there. Yeah. Exactly. And I'm gonna be totally okay.
Those poor
with all of those burritos not getting eaten.
That's why you have a burrito
totally
shield. Right.
Those like, poor squirrels at Virginia
dude,
Tech.
It's raining yeah. burritos, yeah. dude.
Oh my god.
Now see, Burning Man, the burrito drone delivery. All right. I'm talking to you there.
Oh man.
Might have been a nice thing to have.
But still Chipotle. But maybe.
But still Chipotle.
Maybe down the road this will
I
work for
like
other
Chipotle.
Oh,
I mean, I know the E. coli thing took some of the bloom off the rose, but
yeah.
so to speak. But that was good food, isn't it? Is it?
I'm the wrong person to ask because I'm Mexican American and I grew up eating Mexican food.
Yeah,
like my family.
Before
made.
You go home, you got so go to go to Elroy's Taco Truck over here.
This is where it's at.
Elroy's, as in the king. It's awesome.
Right? Yeah, yeah.
It's voted widely agreed to be the best burrito in North Central Petaluma.
We're doing that. We are doing
I
that.
Think, I you said cheeseburger. I was like, I didn't eat
you already well, hit we, the we all three of us drove here together, so we can definitely yeah. make that happen.
You already hit the in and out.
Three nerds, one Jeep.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, God.
Full of burritos.
But no, I mean, Chipotle's great for a lot of people love Chipotle.
Again,
I just don't.
We live in San Francisco.
I apologize to all those who
do.
We grew
care?
Up in the Southwest.
You know what's up.
Our parents are Mexican.
You know what's up. Robbie knows what's up.
I used to live in Mexico.
He used to live in Mexico, so we have a very, like, our burrito. And if you live in San Francisco, you have very strong opinions about burritos.
Yeah.
Like, more so than, like, I think anywhere else in the world.
Yeah. I'm sorry to be a burrito snob.
Yeah, we're burrito
I'm
snobs.
Not.
So everyone else
oh,
on the rest
news.
Of the country, please enjoy your Chipotle de burritos.
The Elroy Taco Truck is so authentic. It's not open on Sundays.
Oh,
so sorry.
All right.
Do we care about Facebook and the human editors and then the fake news and the trending topics?
Yes, a little bit because either A, get rid of trending topics because it's just not, it's an embarrassment for the company, or B,
they helped make it an embarrassment.
Hire somebody.
Well, no, they did, and then they had to fire them because...
Well, they're like, oh, we don't... Because there was, like, really no oversight. There's like, oh, here, just throw some people
nobody
into it
looked at
and
that
just
box.
See what happens. Someone must be looking at it. Someone's clicking on it.
So, trending right now on my Facebook, CM Punk. I don't even know what that is. Oh, it's a UFC thing.
Okay. Mine's Raspberry Pi.
Galaxy Note 7. Canadian airline passengers warned not to use a Note 7. And Steve Harvey... meets his lookalike on Family Feud.
Oh,
man. I take back everything I said about the trending box. That is awesome.
They're my trending bots. You win.
Does anybody, I mean, I think that whole right-hand gutter on Twitter is, I mean, on Facebook is really kind of not
It's kind of garbage.
Used. It's garbage, right?
Facebook.
I've clicked on trending like three times since it started.
It's just.
And twice, two of those times were on accident.
You don't go to Facebook because they're good at software design. You don't go to Facebook because it's beautiful. You don't go to Facebook because there's things on the right. You go to Facebook because your friends are on Facebook.
You're hoping there's something interesting in
your
that,
family's on
in
Facebook.
That news feed.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's you know, that whole, it's a barren wasteland of nothing.
It pretty much is.
Yeah.
There's all this outrage about Facebook banning the photo from Vietnam of the girl with the napalm girl because she was naked.
That outrage to me seems fair.
That's because it's all they don't.
Anybody who grew up at least
censorship,
in the era of the Vietnam War will recognize that photo as very, very, very famous.
Yeah.
And it never struck my mind that it was, she's naked. But that's probably because they have some sort of automated system, right?
Well, to me, this is more important than that trending box, is what do their algorithms look like for determining what you see in your newsfeed?
Right.
And determining what should be pulled from your newsfeed that is being shared by people. Yeah.
And of course, they reinstated it, but they can't do that onesie twosie all the time.
Which is really important because Facebook is the internet for so many people.
Exactly.
Plus, Facebook wants to be the internet for third world countries, for markets that are coming up. They're like, oh, we're going to give you free internet. Well, they're giving you free internet because it looks awesome on their spreadsheet. Look at these monthly active users who are Facebook users.
Right.
So if Facebook's controlling the internet for so many people, but it's like, you know what? We're letting robots censor things.
Yeah.
There's no easy answer to this. Good editorial oversight is going to be expensive, well, hard, and fraught.
Well, you've got a billion and a half users.
Right. No, no, my point is it should be expensive, difficult, and fraught because that's how it is for everyone else in the world of media. Mm-hmm. Facebook wants to abdicate its responsibility here and say, well, we're not a media company.
They say we're not a media company.
They are absolutely the largest media company in the world, hands down, and they need to step up their responsibility and act properly. It's going to be an investment. It's going to be a struggle. They're going to make mistakes, but they can't keep throwing their arms up in the air going,
we don't know. We're not a media company.
Yeah, when you're worth over $300 billion, you can afford to invest in things that make your product work. That is not, you know, punishing. So Facebook needs to just grow up.
Yeah.
Mark, get on that.
You nailed it.
Do your job, Facebook.
If you want to have a big event and announce new products, probably the worst time to do it would be the day Apple's having a big event and announcing new products. But that didn't stop Sony and Dell.
Wait, Dell had an event?
Yeah, you see.
And Nest had news the day after.
I had it right there.
And LG announced their phone the day before.
Yeah, I saw that. That was...
Yeah.
Are they trying to bury their
news? I think we should do... Yeah. Here we are at the end of the show.
The phone was made out of poop.
This would be a good time to talk about all the things that Apple's announcement eclipsed. Dell announced... Dell announced that they had concluded the acquisition of EMC. This is not a small story. This is the largest tech acquisition in history. How much? 50 billion? 62 billion?
74.9.
Jeez, Louis.
No, I made that up, Leo. I have no idea.
No, I think it's in the 60s.
I think it was 6.
Yeah, 62 billion, something like that. 37 billion. I don't know. It was a lot of money. Who cares? At that point, it's a lot.
I'm a little okay with that since that's not a consumer play. That's really an enterprise play. If you care about the Dell EMC news, you know, you're looking for something different than versus like Sony announcing a new PlayStation the day of the iPhone.
$67 billion. I was only off by a little bit.
67.
Yeah. Oh, Kanye West had an event too.
Yeah. No count. No.
Yeezy
season
4 that same day. So.
Chat room.
Yeah.
Was it?
I saw. Yeah. What is that Yeezy season 4 thing? What
it's
is
like
that?
His new clothing line.
It's a bunch of women in beige leotards. I don't get it.
Yeah.
I could wear a beige leotard.
I'm sorry. I don't get it. That's it? Those are the clothes?
Those are the clothes. Those are the clothes. Yeah.
Beige is not the best color in the world.
He's going with a lot of neutrals, like beige.
Look what he's wearing.
We were actually talking about what color this is.
The guy in a beige shirt.
Is this cream?
No, it's
like off-white.
We had a long drive up here. I think we said it was it's the color of vomit after a weekend in the Hamptons.
You said that. And then
I said it's the color of a hazel-flavored non-dairy creamer.
Oh, it is. It
looks hazelnut, non-dairy creamer flavor. That's what I said.
This is not Yeezy, though. This is J. Crew. But still, you know.
It could be Yeezy.
It could.
Was it white when it started?
No, it's. I bought it in this...
Did you wash it in tea?
No. I bought it in this strange color just so I could get crap on this show, actually.
It was in the car, and now it's on the show. We still have to drive back, too.
Yeah, we do.
But we're going to ice cream first, though, right?
We can't get tacos, so.
Yeah, ice cream. All right.
Warner Brothers reports its own site as illegal.
That is hilarious to me.
Hey, those guys over there at the Warner Brothers site are pirating our flicks. They use, of course, a third-party takedown tool. The company discovered that Vobile is the name of it. Vobile is, by the way, nasty. They file hundreds of thousands of takedown requests a month.
Jesus.
So they're a little overambitious. The Torrent Freak said Vobile had made a few mistakes taking down. It flags its own Warner Brothers website as a piracy portal. Batman: The Dark Knight. They did a DMCA takedown on The Dark Knight. Also on The Matrix. Actually, I think it was The Matrix 2, which I think we all agree should be removed.
I've never seen The Matrix 2 or 3.
You missed nothing.
3 is good.
I know, and I didn't see it.
And 3 is good?
Just 3
is
2. 3 is better than 2.
I mean,
1 is so far ahead of
Godfather 3 is to Matrix 2, right?
Godfather 3, actually... Okay, so Matrix 2 bridges something between Matrix 1 and 3. 3 is great.
It's like a transition.
I feel like Godfather 3 just shouldn't exist. Like, Godfather 3...
If like the two Matrix movies, is from what I hear.
So Google...
what I'm trying to say is Godfather 3 is like an abhorrent mistake that should never happen in like...
Oh, that's a great movie.
It is a trash movie from beginning. At least there's a couple scenes in Matrix 2 that are kind of like, it's not so bad. And then you can't have 3 without 2. I mean, but Godfather 3, it should have stopped.
You could have just had Matrix 1, and then right before Matrix 3 starts playing, you're like...
What happened?
What
previously on The Matrix.
That would have been good. That would have been good.
Star Wars started in episode 4 or whatever, right? Why not start at Matrix 3?
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, apparently that story has even eclipsed Sony's announcement. I started talking about it and Sony? I just forgot. They announced a new slimmer PlayStation 4, which will be available like soon, right away.
Yeah.
And then they announced the PlayStation Pro, formerly codenamed, speaking of The Matrix, Neo.
Yeah.
And their virtual AI headset used to be called Morpheus. Just saying.
Like the movie.
Yeah, it's a Matrix.
Four more names left.
It'll be late next month for the PlayStation Pro. It will. Now, there's some debate over whether it'll truly be 4K or upsampled 4K. But weirdly enough, it does not include Sony's own UHD 4K video player, the Blu-ray player.
Which makes no sense to me at all.
How did Microsoft put that in theirs, but Sony just...
Wait, does Microsoft have Sony's player?
Actually, I don't know who makes the one inside of there, but I wouldn't be surprised.
It's not technically, but Blu-ray is the
Sony technology.
So
I bought an Xbox One S because it has a 4K UHD Blu-ray player.
So are you going to buy the PlayStation 4 Pro?
Because I want the VR. Sure.
Okay.
I feel like every time
I don't have a PS4, so that's different. If you had a PS4, I probably wouldn't.
Because I already have a PS4.
It's a faster processor.
Yeah.
It's a bigger hard drive. It's a terabyte hard drive.
Yep.
Will be supported on everything.
Yeah.
And in fact, we talked about this yesterday on the new screensavers. No VR company making VR gaming or software is making it for the high end. They always want to make it for the lowest, the minimal processor that people will be using. So it's guaranteed to run fine on your old PS4.
It's just, I own a PS4. I love it. And I was really looking forward to this PS4 Pro announcement.
Disappointing.
And I watched it, and they just did a terrible job of explaining why I should buy it. They're like, well, the processor is more powerful, and some games will tap into that. But not all.
But most won't.
And those games need to update it, right?
Yeah. Okay. And then they're like, but, you know, it's also going to be able to support 4K. But not all games will be in 4K, but most games will actually be in 1080p. But it's also going to do HDR, but not all. It's like
incidentally,
what the hell is it going to do?
You're going to get an HDR update on your original
on
PlayStation
my PS4.
4.
Exactly.
So you're not
exactly.
really missing anything. Exactly. I would say if you've got a PS4, there's absolutely no reason.
And I think this kind of helps Microsoft with their next, you know, Xbox codenamed product Scorpio coming sometime next year.
Yeah.
Because Sony did such a bad job of articulating the tangible difference that these games are going to have with the PS4 Pro.
Did you just whisper, Scorpio?
No, that was me. Sorry.
Oh, wow.
It's just like, you know.
Well, I can do it for you. Scorpio.
It's like why would I buy the Pro? I want a reason to give them my money.
You don't need to.
And they just aren't giving me one.
You don't need to.
I have a PlayStation 3 still.
You want to give it away, but they're not.
Yeah, I have a PlayStation 3. I upgraded.
I
bought that for the Blu-ray player.
Yeah.
Wait, maybe I have a PlayStation 2.
It's a great Blu-ray player.
Do you not have a Blu-ray player?
No, it must be this. It has a Blu-ray player. I don't know.
Does it look like a barbecue? Is it kind of like
a little
bit shiny?
Yeah, I think it was.
That's the 3.
Okay.
We've played PlayStation 3 games together.
Okay,
it's a 3.
What game do you guys play?
Well, we used to play.
I play like one game a year.
We play Borderlands
for about an hour.
Borderlands is supposed to be fun.
Borderlands is really fun.
Kind of cute.
That's the only game I played like more than 30 minutes in the last 5-6 years.
No Man's Sky.
Don't buy
anybody play No Man's Sky?
Yeah, there's no reason to buy
it. I was excited about it
until
it came out.
I was really excited about it.
And then
got kind of boring.
Yep.
I haven't played it yet. Is it boring?
It depends on what kind
of
game
you
like to play.
You need a lot of time.
You need a lot of time, and you have to be okay with repetition because basically you just like go to.
So it's like.
You go
so
to
let's
planets.
Say you're in jail.
Yeah. Yeah. So you
got a lot of time in life. It's a perfect game for you.
You enjoy repetition.
You go to different planets.
Games that are work. That's
like,
not good.
Yeah. It's just you mine.
I don't like grinding.
You mine like elements and you look for different metals and then you like tag animals and then you just do it over.
No.
Oh my God.
I would much rather lose to 14-year-olds calling me names in League of Legends.
Wow. That's another.
It's way more important to me.
Let's take a break and celebrate Star Trek's anniversary.
50 years?
Right? Yeah, in just a moment. But first, a word from Harry's. Anybody need a shave?
Probably.
You know, Harry, they're now
on
Target,
good.
By the way. This is awesome.
They're
Harry's.
In Target?
Yeah. Harry's is amazing. You know, they're kind of the Apple of razor blades, and by which I mean they make improvements, but they don't raise the price. So they've made some significant improvements to the Harry's razors. They're half the price of the drugstore blades. They've now added the nose trimmer. Blade there. That's really good. The softer flex hinge, the lubricating strip, which I know everybody wants, and the texture handle is so nice. Harry's $2 a blade. So the deal is, of course, as with all of these, you got to start with the handle. So go get a Harry's kit. They get some great deals. The Truman kit, normally $15, includes the handle, three blades, a full size, not a sample size, but a full size of either Harry's foaming shave gel or the cream, which I like because it gives me a nice smooth shave, and the travel cover. And all of that, $15. If you go to harrys.com/twit, you'll get $5 off your first purchase. So get started with $10. Harry's was founded by two friends to offer guys a great shave at a fair price. They own the factory in Germany where they make the blades. That's how come they can get the price down. They're selling direct, factory direct to you. And this limited time offer of $5 off your first purchase at harrys.com/twit. So don't go to Target to get your Harry's, at least not your first Harry's. Get it online, harrys.com/twit. We're all big fans. I'm always clean shaven thanks to Harry. harrys.com/twit. You're too young probably to be a Star Trek fan.
Right? Oh, way too young, yeah.
Really?
Wait, whoa.
You don't
what?
Know about what? Anything, do you?
Too young? All you know about being made right now.
I hear they're trash. I'm not jumping on the boat 35 million years after it's already been out.
September 8th.
Hold on, Next Generation's on Netflix.
How old
so
are you?
Good. I'm 32. Exactly. I watched Next Generation as a kid. You can watch
If
that.
I was a half decade older, I'd be on the show.
Oh, God. So what do kids your age watch?
Pokemon.
I don't have friends.
Pokemon.
I don't have friends.
Pokemon Go.
You watched Pokemon, didn't you?
No. I was super religious when I was growing up, and I didn't have a lot of television. And
so you watched the Veggie Friends? The Veggie Friends?
No, he dated
Veggie
Tales.
Veggie Tales.
Oh, for real?
The one.
All that stuff. Yeah, I said the CDs and stuff and sing along.
Oh.
Jesus. Yeah, I don't know what Veggie Tales is.
It's a Christian animated. It's like the successor to Davy and Goliath.
Bob the Tomato, Larry the Cucumber, the whole crew.
There you go.
Yeah, he's round tomato.
Bob the Tomato. Which one was Pontius Pilate?
That was the zucchini.
Never did trust those zucchinis.
Whoa. There was a zucchini. That was Pontius Pilate?
Wait.
Hold on.
That's not fair.
That's not fair to zucchinis.
It was a Brussels sprout? I don't know. What's a non-inappropriate vegetable?
Brussels sprout would be good.
Okay.
But I think Judas was the Brussels sprout.
I was seven.
Yeah, I could see that. Brussels sprouts can really.
Nobody likes it.
They'll
Brussels
turn on
sprout.
You.
I mean, so VeggieTales got pretty heavy. Like, was there like, did they. Was there murder?
Did they crucify?
Yeah, they crucifery to make the Old Testament story of Meshach, Abednego, and Rednego. I can't pronounce the names anymore.
Abednego.
But, yeah. Abednego.
Three songs with Larry, the part of the show where Larry comes out and sings a silly song.
Got the munchies on that fateful night around 8 o'clock.
Really?
So I phoned in a pizza for delivery.
This is nice. This is sweet.
But I had a feeling.
It's actually funny. It's good. It's cute.
Unlike Christian rock, which
but
is
they,
not.
But they sneak some.
Oh,
they sneak some
Christian rock.
But I mean, did they crucify one of the veggies?
No,
they did not.
That's all I want.
No crucifixion.
I mean, Pontius Pilate. There was no like veggie trial, and the cucumber
all right,
was like.
Happy anniversary, Star Trek. We're done.
I'm declaring victory on that.
Should not
one.
Have brought that up.
This new series, I'm actually genuinely excited for this.
What's
new series.
The new series?
Oh, I thought
Discovery,
you were
Star Trek Discovery, and it's going to be on that CBS. I don't want to pay CBS for their damn streaming
service.
Does
it follow in the J.J. Abrams reboot Star Trek universe, or is it a completely
Ooh,
different?
That's
universe?
A great question because those are two different.
They're two different universes.
Two different canons.
Yeah.
Oh snap!
So which canon?
I don't know, but it's supposed to be a prequel to the original Kirk and Spock.
So if it's a prequel, then it's the original universe.
Well, because there was Enterprise. No, well, because there could be a prequel.
Kirk is in the reboot.
Dear God.
It's actually the later stuff that changes in the reboot, not the earlier stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
You guys sound like One Direction fans right now.
I love
like, oh
Harry.
My God, no, Zayn left in 99. Yeah. No, it's 99 and a half. Yeah. Get it right. It was actually March. All it's right. Q1, so we can right. round down. Like,
I love this story. Intel spent.
I didn't know any of the people's names in One Direction, and now I know. So you know more about One Direction than Star Trek.
I know.
We all look bad right now.
What's amazing is I still look better than you in that situation.
No, but we're speaking to the nerd audience.
Really was, I mean.
Dude,
who likes
I don't
Star
need
Trek? Raise your hand. There we go.
Not Two one person raised their
people,
hand.
People are at home are like this.
Calm down.
Yeah.
I want to be right on this one.
I'm more of a Star Trek than a Star Wars guy. I don't actually like Star Wars all that much.
That's fine, Ben.
Wow. I like Star Trek.
You don't like Star Wars?
What is this, nerd confessionals?
I think Lucas... George Lucas is kind of a hack.
Ooh.
George Lucas's wife made the original Star Wars watchable.
You guys,
boom.
I mean, like, okay, 1, 2, and 3
no,
were
I love
great,
Star Wars.
But damn.
Damn.
No, I'm on, I like both equal.
I'm saying, do you have to choose one? Can't we just enjoy a bowl?
No, you don't have to choose one.
I mean, that's where I'm at.
Intel, 6 years ago, Intel did an interesting thing. They bought McAfee for $7.7 billion, thereby fueling John McAfee's strange descent into madness.
I've met John McAfee. he's everything you would think and more.
How much of the $7.7 billion did he get? Probably not a lot.
I don't know, but there was the Belize thing, the murder, the on the run bit, the Vice News segment.
He was making soap. He was libertarian candidate for president.
His entourage is interesting.
I would expect it to be interesting. Yeah.
Anyway, it didn't work out too well for Intel, and so now they're selling it off. They changed the name to Intel Security, but they gave... Now, this is really the mistake. They're putting the McAfee name back on it
before they sell it away.
Because satire is dead.
Well, they can't let someone else buy the Intel name.
No, it can't
name,
be Intel,
right?
Security.
So... Well, TPG will probably change the name, though, right?
If TPG doesn't change the name, dear heavens.
But I still saw McAfee on like this trialware that I would get on the HPs. I think they may have been using that in the consumer space still anyway.
Wow.
I know.
I mean, it is a well-known name.
And it's, you know, this could be a different McAfee.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be that McAfee.
Yeah.
Pokemon Go, fastest game ever, did $500 million in revenue. And now it's over. It's amazing.
It's not over. They just had the Apple event.
I just think people, like a lot of players have sort of stopped. But there's apparently always going to be people who just keep going.
There's a big update coming.
Yeah, it's probably plateauing.
Yeah.
And with the update, they'll get a little kick.
How about Mario Run on the first non-Nintendo hardware?
To me, that was the most surprising thing at the Apple event.
And Shigeru Miyamoto comes out on stage. I mean, this guy is the Steve Jobs of video gaming, right? Yeah, I mean, this guy's a legend.
Yeah.
In fact, Nintendo values him so much, they won't let him drive to work. Because they're afraid he'll get in an accident. He's that valuable to them.
Or that bad of a driver.
Why not both?
Maybe they know something
like that. They're like, all right, dude.
You're not even good at Mario Kart.
I've been in a car with you. No, I understand. I know. Mario Kart. I get it. Yeah. We're gonna get you a driver.
Yeah.
And they're gonna
drive
you a tank.
But no, we're gonna get you a driver. Just, it's good.
I did not know this, but there is an Israeli online attack service called VDOS that anybody with $30 a month to spare can use to DDoS any site on the internet.
Wow.
Oh, yeah, you could do that stuff.
Krebs on Security. Brian Krebs has a great article, came out on September 8th, about VDOS. They call it a booter service, and they estimate they've made more than $1 million, the two Israeli people behind it, selling for a subscription. $19.99 for the bronze level.
Oh, jeez.
$29.99 for the silver level. $39.99 for the gold level. VIP, $199.99.
Should have called that one ceramic.
Bam.
And they can launch an attack anywhere from a few gigabits a second to something like 64 gigabits a second.
NSO Group is also Israeli, right? The
Israelis are the best hackers.
Yeah,
they have
incredible.
Because everybody goes in the military.
But their cybersecurity industry there is really impressive. Or dangerous, depending on your perspective. Yeah. But it's worth keeping in mind that that's where a lot of the stuff is coming from.
But if you've wondered why, and we've had some DDoS attacks. Steve Gibson's Security Now has some DDoS attacks. If you wondered why they seem so prevalent, it's because it costs $30 and any script kitty can do it. It doesn't require any skill at all.
Well, a lot of sites have protections against them, and they can.
You know what the irony is?
But I wonder if you pay $200 and you.
What do you get?
What if you go after a site and it turns out that site is just like, nah, we're good. You can't do it. Do you get your money back?
I don't know. The irony is VDOS used Cloudflare's DDoS protection for itself. It was buying Cloudflare.
Well, that makes sense.
Isn't Cloudflare doing really well?
Yeah. Apparently. Maybe VDOS is, who knows, maybe they are hand in hand. I mean, they have a symbiotic relationship. I don't know. When I read this, it was like, wow.
Yeah, you can buy anything.
It's a great article. Cloudflare delays IPO plans. Why is that?
I haven't read the article yet. I was trying to do that quietly so I didn't just talk about
Headline is... And Guccifer 1.0 gets 4 years in prison. Doesn't mean Guccifer 2.0 is going to be daunted. Guccifer, Marcel Lahel Lazar, a 44-year-old Romanian, hacked George H.W. Bush. George W. Bush, he uncovered Hillary Clinton's private email server. He's getting 52 months.
Well, he said he broke into it, and then he had to retract because he actually couldn't show that he actually did break into it. And that he ended up having to tell the FBI that he lied on Fox News about it.
Bad enough that he's a hacker, but to lie to Fox News, shocking.
I know.
That has never happened once in the history of cable television.
Months.
Which makes you wonder, like, how much of the stuff that he's said he's done is actually...
Yeah, maybe. Colin Powell, Robert Redford, Steve Martin, and Nicole Kidman, supposedly among... his convictions. He gained unauthorized access to personal email and social media accounts belonging to 100 celebrities, according to the U.S. Justice Department. I know, you know. And then, of course, his name has been reused. Guccifer 2.0 is the, we think, actually, it's a Russian state hacking group with hacks of the Democratic National Committee.
No. Well, Romania and Russia are so far apart.
Anyway, just, you know, this is This Week in Security News. Anything else you guys want to talk about before we call it a day? We can wrap it up. We've been going on and on forever.
I have a shout out, which is Robbie's shirt.
I love that shirt.
It's the gingham, bluish, grayish thing that we all wear all the time.
It's really good.
He's grabbing the normal nerd look.
It's beautiful.
It's not just any normal nerd shirt. It is. Go ahead.
It's the shirt that Alec Baldwin wears in Beetlejuice.
There you go.
How good is that?
How do you know?
How good is that?
I was on a Facebook Live video thing for Engadget, and someone said that, and I thought that was the funniest thing I'd ever heard. I don't know if it's exactly... I haven't even looked it up.
Let's look this up.
Let's look it up. Let's see.
I want to get a side-by-side.
Alec Baldwin.
We should call Alec Baldwin.
No, he's crazy.
For Halloween, you should get like that stretched out face with the eyeballs in the, you know, in the middle.
Oh, his is a little... The
No, it's not the same. His was flannel.
That's not the same.
Yeah, it's not the same.
But you do wear those glasses, and your hair could be exactly the same.
You're on your way.
And the pattern needs to be larger.
Yeah, I think it's close.
I also need to be a little bit crazier.
What a great movie. Classic.
Yeah.
Tell me you've seen that, Alex. Young Alex.
Beetlejuice?
Yeah.
Don't say it more. That's twice now. Stop. Have you seen it?
Beetlejuice. I haven't seen it.
You haven't seen it? Jesus.
Actually, you say it three times and Coulter appears. That's the
story. Oh.
Retract. That was off the record.
Oh my God.
Well, actually, can we talk about politics? I'm kidding.
No, after the show, we'll talk about politics.
Fair enough.
It's hard. You know what? I have to admit, it's hard not to talk politics.
Well, it's election year.
It is, and only 9 weeks left.
Oh my God.
Please. So get
That's
going.
Terrifying. That's terrifying.
Get going. I think we could wrap this up. It's really been fun. You guys got to come back. And come back as a group. It could be the comedy stylings of Alex Wilhelm from Mattermark.com.
Hello. I hope my jokes weren't as bad as usual.
Nathan Olivarez-Giles from Wall Street Journal. That's a pretty prestigious address, Wall Street.
Yeah.
It's pretty good.
Yeah, it's a nice name.
Not bad. Yeah. Feels good there.
And he's hyphenated, so.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. Hyphens.
And Roberto Baldwin. Alec Baldwin's weird brother.
No, he has enough of those, actually. Yeah. To be perfectly honest.
Weird brothers to
Alec Baldwin's family is quite insane.
You guys are always fun. It really was a great show. It was well worth paying a Mac Pro for.
I'm going to put this to good use. Lots of Final Cut. Yeah,
good luck.
It's going to be good.
Yeah, I hope it works for you.
And milkshakes.
And if there is an old Minecraft server on there, just... You could delete it.
Not a problem.
We do this show every Sunday afternoon, 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern, 2200 UTC. If you want to watch live, you can. And join us in the chat room at irc.twit.tv. But, of course, you don't have to because on-demand versions of all of our shows are available at our website, twit.tv, or wherever you get your podcasts. Every podcast aggregator has This Week in Tech. One of the oldest shows in the podcasting universe. 11 years old. We also are, as you probably noticed, in our new East Side Studios, and we're celebrating with some new T-shirts and mugs, and we've got a hooded, a hoodie pullover. If you go to teespring.com/twit, there's not much longer left on this. We only do these for 30 days to create some false sense of urgency.
Do you throw them in a ditch and light them on fire when you're done?
Oh, yeah. We bulldoze them out. We bring them to Alamogordo, New Mexico, and put them in there with ET cartridges.
I knew that was coming.
See those again.
Yeah.
Go to teespring.com/twit. We've got sizes for every person in your family, female as well as male. And there are 14 days left, just 2 weeks left. So I think they're pretty nice. And the back is what I like. That's the new East Side Studio.
East Side Studio, nice.
Yeah. It's to commemorate the East Side Studio.
East Side.
That is a nice job by Anthony Nielsen, who did our design. And get the hoodie, says Creamy Corn Cob. Get the hoodie.
Someone earlier said it was Jason's birthday. Were they talking about Jason Howell?
Or? Is it Jason Howell's birthday? I think it is. Happy birthday, Jason Howell. I forgot to say anything.
Yay, yeah. Happy birthday.
Hey.
Good guy.
Are we allowed to sing that song anymore? I don't remember.
No, we can now.
Oh, we can.
We can now.
Robbie, you're a rock star.
It's no longer owned by
I'm not getting paid,
Warner
I don't
Chappelle
say.
Music.
I'll pay you.
Can you sing it in the style of Prince?
No, God, no.
How much money to sing it right now?
I did do the Prince concert not too long ago.
So Robbie is in a number of really successful, like...
cover bands.
Cool cover bands. And he's
Do they have clever names like?
No, I don't believe in puns for names.
But the names are still cool.
Yeah, they're still, but they're all names of like the Prince band's controversy.
Okay,
so it's not like it's not.
But
like,
you wouldn't know.
It's
know,
not like Purple Rain,
marquee.
Like R-E-I-G-N right. or something,
which actually exists.
Yeah, yeah. It's and then the Bowie band is Queen Bitch. Can I say bitch on here?
No. Mm-hmm.
All right.
He's all,
no. yes. And then the LCD sound, the regular band where we do LCD sound system and punk and Talking Heads is North American Scum. And then I have like a completely different band that does originals, and that's Drastic Cats.
Drastic Cats.
So that's
look.
Oh, and
those.
Then I have a Devo band.
You do?
Yeah, it's Suburban Robots.
That's good.
Wow. Devo's one more thing Alex has.
Yeah, that's another thing he doesn't
know. We should
know
not
about.
Eat before we do the show. It's too confession. All right.
That came out during lunch.
Yeah. Like, everything I do, here. Alex doesn't understand.
And vice versa. So it works
that's true. He talks about math. I'm all.
You'd heard of Devo.
What is
right?
math?
I'd heard of Devo. Yeah. I hadn't heard Devo.
Yeah. I love this. He's like, yeah, I've heard of Devo. I just don't really know what. I mean, like,
it's very 80s.
I just, yeah. I don't think I know Devo.
He was busy watching VeggieTales.
Actually, I was alive for 5 months of the 80s. Yeah, so, yeah. You know, what can you do?
5 months of the
80s. I was alive for
the last five
months.
Best ones.
Oh, man.
Yeah. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you to our great studio audience. If you want to be here. Hey, Shuby, how you doing? Shuby, my first intern.
All right.
Yeah. Hey. Now he's a big shot in New York City advertising.
Ooh.
Yeah. Nice to see you, Shuby. If you want to join us in the studio audience, you can email, unless you're Shuby, you don't have to do it if you're Shuby, but if you are anybody but Shuby, should email tickets at twit.tv and we will put a chair out for you. Thanks to Michael O'Donnell, who is now on his, what is this, 23rd episode of this show. He's been to many of them. Our staff photographer at this point. Look for those. Are you going to post some of those images? I think you posted them. Yeah. He's at photo on Twitter. So you could probably see
at photo? Man.
I know.
It's been early to get that one.
I know.
Damn.
We're sitting with at Alex and at photo.
And at string, Robbie's Twitter handle.
Stringways.
With no vowels.
No vowels.
Vowelless stringways.
Back in the early days of the internet, you weren't allowed to have
one
vowels.
We didn't have vowels.
And then we were allowed vowels, and then the whole app revolution happened. Now vowels are gone again.
It's the big vowel movement.
Yeah, it's the vowel movement.
As a matter of fact,
The vowel movement?
The vowel movement.
I don't know if that's what you want to be saying.
No, thanks, everybody, for joining us. Another twit is literally in the can. Thank you.